it's like they're reanimating Orca 6 via new bodies.
Well, at first glance, that would benefit Mayor Clark the most because, you know, she, if she loses this next election, she doesn't have to wait for a year to get her job back with the city. But I was also thinking of previous council. Oh, well, we got voted out. Okay, we'll apply for a job with the city now because we know all the city.
Okay. All right. I like that one. Check this one out. There are currently no private investigators registered in the city of Medicine Hat. Bob Tetz closed his license after the Monarch Theater bullshit. Only one person has applied for a private investigator's license in Medicine Hat in the past 3 years. He's on a tentative right now. It's Sod, the guy that owns the pizza place downtown. Also runs his own security company. He got his PI license. Medicine Hat is so void of current PI, and they like it when the PI that they can use is in their fucking pocket. Andy McGrogan is going to leave city council, open a private business that does private investigations, and he's going to solicit the city for a contract for $565,000 a year, and he is going to provide security and investigations for the city. Oh, is there any pecuniary investigationals that need to be done? Thank you, Commissioner of blah, blah, blah. I'll take care of it now because you've pointed out that somebody might have pecuniaried. Well, as the big-time investigatory guy who used to be chief, I'm going to pecuniarily look into the, oh, nobody did anything wrong. Thanks for the money.
Yeah.
That's what's going to happen. Mark my words, that's what's going to happen.
Oh, I totally believe you, yeah.
He either wants to be mayor, or he wants to be a private company that gets fucking money, like way more money than he's getting paid as counselor. And he won't have to work at all. He'll own a business that has a fucking $500,000 contract with the city. He'll kick back, and he'll hire a guy like Sod to actually fucking manage the HR, hire the people, run the whatever, you know what I mean? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, see, if he runs for mayor next time, so, okay, if he loses the election, yeah, then he can open up his private eye thing.
Exactly.
Fall back on, for sure, yeah.
Or maybe he'll do both, because they'll change the policy so much that you'll be allowed to be mayor and a business owner that contracts with the city for $500,000 a year at the same time.
Yeah, it was February 23, 2022. Let me look up the specific bylaw. 4694.
I know that if you watch the Mr. Marion video that I edited there, you will know that the part where people are cheering at the end was obviously where Mayor Clark entered the room. And I put inspirational music in the background, which is like very like not news. You know what I mean? Like news shouldn't like add inspirational music to make somebody sound like way better. But in the context of everything that is happening, and the missing context that is being used as misinformation by the current city council.
So we're live now, eh?
Oh, it went right on? All right. Let me just check.
Check them.
I gotta rename the live probably. It probably is the old, will they go off the rails again? Yeah.
Yes. They went off the rails.
Yes, they did go off the rails. We might just have to update it and say they did go off the rails. Let me edit the post here. Yeah. Shit show continues. They went off
the hell? Rails again.
Okay, wow. It is Wednesday, my dudes. Thank you for joining Community TV. your local Trash Panda. We are an independent news organization that provides all kinds of local media so that we can have local conversations about how we should understand what's going on in our community. Specifically lately, it's been about municipal politics, and that's why Kelly is always grinning. You know, sometimes what happens is Kelly's getting way, way into other people's weeds. And the weeds of, for instance, city councilors, you know, the manager of the city, the CAO, her contingency fund. Kelly's getting into all kinds of receipts, logs, data. And like sometimes, you know, she's got, I would say, the attention of like the top 10% academic type people in Medicine Hat that are looking to do a little research. They want to find out what's going on. They want to know, you know, what's the skinny. And they'll read Kelly's article and they'll just be like, wow, not only do I have a good understanding now of what's been going on down at City Hall, I've got this interesting context with words like shit show. I've got something that attracts me and entertains me a little bit while I learn about this. And all of a sudden, you know, we're getting a lot more attention. Kelly all of a sudden is putting articles up that a much wider swath of people are learning from. So I think while we used to post stuff that we had a very limited engagement, sometimes because it was stuff that was just outside the bounds of what normal everyday folks are thinking about, you know? It doesn't seem to affect you if it's just some shit going on down at City Hall. I mean, there's boring 4-hour meetings. You're snoozing by the hour mark, because you're just like, what are they going about, right? So our goal as the Trash Pandas has been to try and make this a little bit more entertaining so that people like you want to engage, because that's what's really important about local media. You know, we could just tell every story factually and you know, not use any kind of entertaining words. You know, it's possible for us to do that, but it would be boring. And then less people would engage with it. We'd be less happy with our work. And that's what it's about. I mean, for Kelly and I think we're looking at more of a long-term game here, where right now, you know, we're sort of fighting for a little bit of attention from you guys. We're trying to provide the viewers out there and the readers out there content that they find entertaining, that enlightens them a little bit, teaches them something about what's going on, maybe in municipal politics, maybe just about their community, and maybe reinforces that it's a good idea to get involved in these conversations, because if they happen without you, we end up getting to the point of a shit show showdown that everybody in Alberta knows about. I think it's going worldwide at this point. Kelly?
The West Coast, and I imagine East Coast.
It's been in a bunch of newspapers. I mean, there was one day that we had, I think there were two articles on the front of like Calgary's biggest newspaper that were about Medicine Hat. And the reason that this is becoming big news is because people are engaging. The legacy news knows that they just want to tell the 30-second or 1-minute stories that people are most interested in. So if there was a puppy rescued from the river and they got the shot, you know, they're going with that right away because it's an easy story to tell. They can't, you know, fill their 23-minute newscast with 20 minutes of, you know, banter about what they think is funny about what happened at City Hall. But we know that the people are interested. We know, I mean, you were down there in droves last night. Not last night, the night before.
Kelly? Yeah, there's both people in the audience, and even an hour in, there's still about 70 people. And at the end of the meeting, which was 4.5 hours long, so we're talking 11 o'clock, there were still 20 people there. Now, that's really unusual, because usually us media outnumber the spectators.
It's usually you and two other media, which are local chat TV, the Legacy News operation, Eli, usually the operator there. Great guy. I've met him personally. I like Eli at chat. And that's all I'll say. I'll say that Colin is the other one there from the newspaper. And I would say that his reputation among local journalists is waning. I mean, there has been articles that I've read in the newspaper where I've said, "Oh, great, Colin, I'm glad you boiled that down for me." There's been other times where I've read articles and I've gone, "Ugh, cringe big time. I do not like the language he's using. I think he'll apologize." And he does later apologize for things that he's written, but usually doesn't use his own name. Like when he writes the apology, it says Medicine Hat News, you know? Or when he's written an article that has some effed up language in it, he'll go back and switch it and it'll say Medicine Hat News. I think it's important that as a journalist, you put your name on the stuff that you write. Like, it's just me and Kelly here. And when we post something, Kelly will say, Kelly here. You know? When I post something, you usually see me in the video going, "Hey, what are you talking about, buddy?" You know? You'll see
Oh,
me.
you can tell the difference by our writing styles, but not everybody can. So I make sure that everyone knows it's me and not you, that I'm not speaking for you. So yeah.
And I mean, sometimes I'll just make the post, and I feel like, yeah, the language really explains it there. Some of them I should probably go back and just be like Tommy here, just so that everybody knows. Because I think there's, yeah, we have a different style of writing, academic and badass, I think is how I would describe yours. Academic badass. My writing style is maybe a little bit more streetwise asshole. I don't know if I was just gonna use two words to describe us. You've got streetwise asshole right here, and if you want to read Kelly's academic badass, you've got it there. But we don't have any kind of like stick up the butt corporate. We don't have that. We don't. Super well-paid shill. No, we don't have that. We don't have anything like that. But if you want to read like complete bullshit malarkey that comes from I don't know where, you can head over to the Sun City Sentinel, which I think, you know, that was actually one of the names I considered when I was doing the rebranding at Community TV, and I'm almost certain that I said it publicly at some point. So you guys stole one of my names that I thought was stupid. The reason I think it's stupid, and extra stupid now, okay, Sun City Sentinel, because it's like a sentinel is the depiction of like like a knight in shining armor holding like usually a long spear, and
A
so
watchdog.
a watchtower, or maybe they've got arrows in the watchtower. It's an armed guard is what a sentinel is, okay? Now, what is the Sentinel currently doing? Well, they're allowing local politicians to sign up as authors and ostensibly write articles and putting pictures of the mayor and writing things that are like, "Oh, you're a conspiracy theorist if you believe anything that the mayor has to say." You got other politicians on city council writing those articles, submitting them anonymously, and it's just like the Sun City Sentinel has this new article, front page news. The mayor is crazy. It's like, that is fucking hilarious.
Well, we don't know if it's the city councilors writing these things. We know that we can see an author account for Shyla Sharps that shows that she hasn't written anything yet, and it's using her city council email address, which is really odd. Now, either
Super
she
sus.
signed up and maybe someone's playing a trick on her, who knows? But what we found interesting was, we're looking for the ownership of the site, and you found the young woman who created the site. And it turns out one of the authors, A. Craig Elder, who is a guy who works for RBC Dominion Securities, I guess, his email address is admin at Sun City Sentinel.
He's the gatekeeper that you have to get past. So the way that the website works is just like any other blog website. It's just, I mean, basically this person grabbed a template, threw Sun City Sentinel on there, and then probably sent out a mass email to a bunch of people that are in the friggin' conspiracy social media secret groups, you know, where we'd find people talking about, I don't know, the LGBTQs are trying to do the predators on the children, all kinds of weird stuff, you know, those kinds of social groups.
And conditions for this site I believe there's a disclaimer in there saying, well, you know, the stuff that's on here may not be true.
Exactly. They grabbed a template of a, they probably went on like Template Monster or some website there. You just download a website that you could fill in all the blanks. And part of the filling blanks was the disclaimer part. They just copy and paste. And basically, the disclaimer on their website says, this is not a news website. Like, we do not provide news. What we provide is a portal for people to write stuff and just blog. It's just whatever anybody thinks. There is no procedure for it. They don't follow any kind of like ethical guidelines.
I got it here in front of me. Says no reliance, clause 23. The content on our website is provided for general information purposes only, not intended to amount to advice on what you on which you should rely. You must obtain more specific or professional advice before taking or refraining from any action or inaction on the basis of the content on our site. Although we make reasonable efforts to update the information on our website, we make no representations, warranties, or guarantees, whether expressed or implied, that the content on our website is accurate, complete, or up to date. So it's, and but you talking intellectual property rights and ownership. Now, people who are writing articles for the site, you don't get paid for it. It says, number clause 14, you understand and agree that the website and its entire contents, features, and functionality, including to but not limited to all information, software, code, text, displays, graphics, photographs, video, audio, design, presentation, selection, and arrangement are owned by the company. Its licensors or other providers of such material and are protected in all forms by intellectual property laws, including without limitation, copyright, trademark, patent, trade secret, and any other proprietary rights.
Is Craig Elder a member of the Medicine Hat Rotary Club?
I do not know. I believe he was the president of the Cypress Club.
Well, it appears as if the only advertising that is on the website for Sun City Sentinel is a QR code that you can scan, and you could win up to $10,000 in a 50-50 draw held on June 25th by the Medicine Hat Rotary Club. So it's like they're selling tickets for the Rotary Club there. I don't know if the Rotary Club has paid them or if there's any kind of
Well,
contractual agreement
other
there.
organizations that write articles, like a couple school districts. I don't know if everyone that is. Oh, here's one. Craig Elder was named to Ronald McDonald House Charities on board of directors. Yeah, isn't that interesting? Well, this was 3 years ago. Yes, you have to have a blog. Now that blog has been taken down. He does have a website called ianparkinson.ca. And I believe I sent you a screenshot. I went in a Wayback Machine. And it provides a link to his blog, which is no longer exists. But let me just read what it said. It was rather interesting. No, there was a link to his blog on, and what it said, Ian's blog, and it's got a link. Caution: content may be contain disturbing information, toxic rhetoric, false news and opinions, indulgent false information, unacceptable views to the limp-wristed, woke, confused members of society. You have been warned. No, it was a Wix thing, I think. Yeah. Okay, here that EN2047, like 2047.wixsite.com, and it no longer exists. Spoke to him this morning. He says he got rid of it 6 months ago, but the Wayback Machine on January 16, 2024 shows it was still there. But
It was
well,
ian2047.wix.com.
yes, EN2047.wixsite.com.
Gotcha. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I love the Wayback Machine. I love receipts. I love that people think that they can just like delete the internet and then it'll just like go away or something like that. Because as the Trash Panda, we are your digital dumpster divers, basically. You can go find the hard drives that they throw away at City Hall and maybe like have a look through them, because I've seen a lot of computer stuff getting tossed out recently. It's as if they're getting all new computer stuff down there. So we gotta maybe do a little security audit and find out whether or not they've formatted all those hard drives, or if they've left something for the trash pandas. Is it possible? So the other night, you're down at City Hall. I'm sitting here broadcasting. I keep the updates coming to Kelly, because I feel like while she's down there, after hour two, for sure you're starting to, get a little tired. It's like around, what, I guess 6:30. It's around 8:30 at that point. 9 o'clock rolls around, it's kind of like, all right, like it's getting close to fucking bedtime at this point. I'm sending messages to Kelly and I'm like, hey, I just want you to know I am still awake. I'm sitting at my computer. I'm listening to every word that's going on. I'm here with you. Kelly's getting the shot while she's down there. So right at the very end, when the mayor started to ask the question and get right into the weeds that nobody wants her in, Kelly was getting the shot of the face reacts. I mean, she told me about the video of the face reacts, but ooh wee, I think that's one we're gonna have to put in the, like, we're making a soundboard of things people have said. And god damn, there was a lot of them the other night. I mean, there was a lot of little soundboard clips that we gotta take from the other night.
Oh yeah.
That one I think is gonna be one of those brilliant visuals. Like when you were bombarding Andy McGrogan a couple of weeks ago, and we got you t he turned towards you, and like I said, it looked like you poked him in the eye after making salsa with your bare hands, and he just cringes at the question that you're asking him, which is
Yeah.
basically, hey Andy, former police chief, current acting mayor, who basically kicked the real mayor out of her job, what do you think about following the law? And he was like, yeah, I'm not gonna talk about who follows laws and who doesn't. It's like, whoa, that's a weird answer for somebody who used to be a police chief.
Yeah.
Really weird answer, dude. Like sus AF for a guy who used to be a cop to be like, I am not concerned with what is legal and not legal. Those things just do not concern me. My job now is to worry about feelings. And the person who gets paid the most amount of money at the horseshoe said that her feelings were hurt. And so I think what I have to do probably is get down on my knees and bow to the queen. Yeah, it's ridiculous how quickly it seems like money and power has turned what we as people voted in as what we thought were going to be transparent city councilors has so quickly become what looks like a freaking money grab. Like, who can get the most the fastest? Who can set up the who can set up some kind of a foundation? And I don't mean like a corporate nonprofit. I mean like the bricks of a building. who can set up some kind of a foundation while they are in, so that when they get out, they can get whatever they want. You know, they can maybe develop something, or they, I don't know what it is they're gonna do, but they're gonna get their claws in somehow. And you know what we realized recently is that there's actually a change to a bylaw that has to do with like timing and conflict of interest. Kelly, explain the bylaw in plain terms and how it changed and what that could mean for the mayor or any city councilor who is trying to make loot after they left their job.
Okay, the bylaw change, and I didn't notice it at the time, I probably should have paid more attention. It happened in February 2022, and it amends Code of Conduct Bylaw 4492.
Bill payers rise to reward.
And what it does is, it used to say, Section 11.4, members shall refrain from using their positions to obtain employment with the municipality for themselves, family members, or closest associates. That part is still in place. What they removed is members are ineligible to apply or be considered for any position with the municipality while they hold their elected position and for 1 year after leaving office. So, election.
A year has to pass so yeah. that the information you have from being on the inside can't instantaneously be used in the world of commerce and trade and getting contracts. Because if I'm, I don't know, let's say I'm Andy McGrogan, and I got all kinds of experience with investigations because I used to be the police chief, and then I'm inside the city for a while and I find out that the city is spending a whole bunch of money on new security contracts. Like, oh my God, $565,000 this year, Ann Mitchell, on security stuff? Okay, that's cool. Maybe Andy McGrogan would leave. You know, he doesn't want to be a city councilor. He doesn't get voted in as mayor. So maybe he starts a company the day that he leaves office. The day that he leaves office, he puts together a proposal that says, hey, city, I know exactly what you need in terms of all security, because I was in there, right? I was in there. I know exactly what you need. So here's a contract for $500,000. Pay me and I'll hook you up. And that would be freaking legal? That would be legal.
Yep.
That does not sound legal. That sounds like it should be illegal. Like, it for sure should be illegal. It's like insider trading, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you'd think so. You know, it's not just the information that you receive, it's the contacts that you make. Because, you know, if you're working with staff, you get the reports at every council meeting. So you develop a relationship over time. And, oh, hey, you know, you're going to be doing this project for the city. Well, you know, how about giving me some inside information so that my company can benefit?
Or it's the connections that are made during that time while you're on city council, you're allowing this and that to pass through. Oh, another $1 million contract, another $5 million contract, a developer from out of town. You know, let's let these guys do their thing. All the while, you have maybe investments in those companies. And the city of Medicine Hat doesn't know that you're making all kinds of money because you have a 10% share in the contracting company that's building the new, what do they call them, high rises over in Harlow. You know, so if you're connected to, know somebody, or you have inside information that makes you get extra money out of the deal, but you only could do that because you held information from inside the city and you held that outside of public, like private city corporate information, and used that to get something, garner maybe a gift. Maybe you got gifted something. They said, hey, you let this contract go through, we'll buy you a cruise, and you know, you and Shyla can go on a cruise down through the Panama Canal, and you know, get all kinds of, you know, have fun there. All of those things are what they were talking about, pecuniary. And you know, it was like you were saying about Kelly and I were talking right before we went live, and I had to get into the live, because when we start talking off camera, I'm like, this is the stuff we should put on camera. We know that. Psychologists say when people are feeling threatened, especially those that are maybe more leaning academic, you know, And we would say for sure most of the people around this horseshoe are at least attempting to appear as if they are in a academic-like field as they trip over all of the Robertson rules and attempting to appear as if they know how to run a board of directors for a big company like the City of Medicine Hat. But it appears as if most of them still at this point haven't done their homework. They don't know the Robertson rules of, you know, just how to actually bring a motion forward, how to second the motion, how motions are modified over time, how committees are involved in the motions. And it is kind of complex. Most of you viewers out there, kind of, I've lost you already when I start talking about Robertson rules. It's not something that most people know about. But the basic, to boil it down, is when they sit around that circle and they talk about new laws and passing, you know, ordinances and making things, how are they going to run the city? They have to do it in a certain kind of order. Kind of like, I don't know, if I could make a really weird comparison, it's like a game of cards. You know, and each one of the people around the table have certain cards that they can play at certain times, but they all have to follow the rules. And it's like a big game of Texas Hold'em. And everybody's just like, okay, I'll stay, and then I'll stay. And then, you know, sometimes the mayor says, well, I'm going to show. And then everybody at the table is like, I'm out. You know, so if you could compare this to a big, big game of poker, the Robertson rules are basically knowing how to play Texas Hold'em. And if you don't know how to play Texas Hold'em and you go to the casino, you look like a freaking fool. If you're at a table with eight other people and one of them is a hotshot. And I'm talking about Mayor Lindsey Clark. If we were making the comparison about a casino and a bunch of people going to play Texas Hold'em, I tell you what, Mayor Lindsey Clark not only knows all of the rules of Texas Hold'em, she used to work for the casino and write the rules about how you freaking play Texas Hold'em. In fact, she wrote the rule about how when you ante up too much money, the casino has to come down and ask you some questions about your financial position. Because if you get down to the table at this casino, where you know Lindsey Clark used to write the rules about how they engage with the public, now, some people will come to a casino and they'll say, listen, I'm putting my car on this. I'm putting the title of my house on this. I know I'm going to hit red. I know I'm getting a full house. I know I got this straight flush. I got a royal straight flush and I know it. Just turn those cards. Lindsay is basically the person at the casino who is so smart that she wrote the rule that says when somebody puts their whole entire life down on a Texas Hold'em game, we pause the game. We have the guys from the casinos in suits go down and say, hey, listen, we see that you're about to bet $500,000 on this game of Texas Hold'em. Now, we put everything on hold because we're going to allow you to walk away from this table right now. We're not suggesting that you're cheating, okay? That's what Lindsay's saying. She even said the other night, I am not suggesting that you have done anything untoward with your credit card. I don't even think that you've done anything wrong. I just want to see your receipts. And it's like being at the casino and the guys in the suits come out and they're saying, listen, we don't think you're cheating, but you just put $500,000 down on a game of Texas Hold'em and we see your house, all right? It's not worth $500,000. The car you got outside, it's still on a lease. We don't want that. You know, like we got this option for you right now, okay? Either you could play this hand and when you lose, we are going to instantly send you to creditors that are going to take all of your stuff on lien, or you can walk away from the table right now. Lindsay knows the rules so well that it is as if these city councilors are amateur poker players that have never played anything outside of, like, you know, watching a game.
Well, Tom, have you ever worked at a casino, like as a volunteer?
I worked at the bingo hall as a volunteer here in Medicine Hat once, and that was a ride.
Well, when my kids were in high school, you know, they would have fundraisers. So some of us parents would go and volunteer at the casino. And so, you know, I worked in the count room. And you know that scene in Casino where they're holding up the box to the camera? We had to do that. You know, and everything is out in the open. And you have to, you know, every stack of bills has to get counted twice and confirmed by someone else.
Because in this situation that I'm talking about here, in this comparison of the city hall, the horseshoe being a casino, and these guys all got to learn how to play Texas Hold'em. They don't know how to play. Lindsay's the hotshot who's there just basically like she's anteing up every time. She's playing the long game. She's coming to the table and she's going, okay, I'll play my cards when I know I've got a good hand. I'm not gonna show out. I'm not gonna, what do they call it when you fake like you've got a good hand but you really don't? She's not bluffing. She didn't come to the table to bluff. She knows what's going on with the game, and she's playing the game really well. She's playing the long game. And Larry, the city clerk, he's sort of like the floor manager. He's just walking around, making sure that the game's being played properly. Nobody's cheating. Everybody's following the rules. The timing's working out, you know. But the casino closes at 11 o'clock tonight, guys. Mm. And the only way that you guys can finish this hand is if a couple of you guys agree. We need basically two of you guys who are sitting at the table just to agree that we keep the casino open another 15 minutes so we can finish this hand and find out whether Ann Mitchell is losing everything that she just anteed up or not, right? Because we just got to see the receipts, that's all. 15 minutes, right?
Receipt for you. I sent you a link to it. It's looking in the campaign disclosures, and I noticed this after the election. Craig Elder gave Cassie Hyder a $1,000 campaign contribution.
I wonder if that has anything to do with her amazing abilities to cheerlead. It seems as if in all cases that I've observed and what we've seen, even people from the public say recently in comment sections and messages to community TV, is that they basically not seen Cassie Hyder do anything pertinent at any city council meeting other than read something that somebody else wrote and second motions that are made by Shiloh Sharps, basically.
Andy McGrogan's campaign, actually it's in the name of Thomas Andrew McGrogan. And he's self-funded, so he's got no campaign contributors to report.
I'm going to pull up the list here for you.
Cassie Hyder, her name is actually Tessa Cassandra Hyder.
Oh.
So it's interesting to see people using their second names all the time. It's, I don't know.
So total amount, she used $5,300. Shit, how many people voted for her?
I don't know. She got more votes than Shiloh did. I think Shiloh was right at the number 8 mark for council members.
No, but actually in terms of number of total votes, like she got about 5,000 people to vote for her?
I'm not sure. I can look that up for sure.
I know this is just like sort of weird extraneous information and I'm connecting dots that probably other people don't give a shit about, but if only 5,000 people voted for her, that's more than a dollar per person. She could have just walked around handing out dollars and been like, hey, vote for me, here's a dollar. And it might have been just as impactful as whatever campaign she ran. She didn't even really run a campaign. I interviewed every single other person that was running and she was the only person that was like, rude to me in terms of like I asked her for an interview and she was like, I would not sit down with you because I don't like what you do. And I was like, can you give me an example of something that I've done that you have some kind of complaint about? And she was like, no, I just don't like you. I've been told by other people that I shouldn't talk. And I was like, oh, I see. You've been told by other people not to talk to me.
Now you got me thinking, because corporate communications, they listed off a bunch of things that they said that we were in violation of, but they wouldn't give me any examples.
That's right. They never give any examples. I got to leave you for a quick second. I have a friend that's come to visit here. Take it away. I'm leaving up on the screen Cassie Hyder's attestation and her numbers. I'll just be back in 30 seconds.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just looking up the election results here. Oh, it's going to take me a minute. But yeah, I posted an article earlier today and talking about how the council has basically effed around and found out how it works without having an experienced chair, because they're switching the deputy mayor roles every 6 weeks. Now, Allison Canoldo, her time is up on April 19, and Andy McGrogan takes over on Saturday, April 20. So, you know, they're going to have a rotation of a new boss every 6 weeks, and that just doesn't go over well when you're trying to provide continuity in a company. And I also talk about, because what did I talk about here? About how when you impose sanctions, you know, you don't do it when you're angry, because you make bad decisions. I mean, you can tell some.
Kelly's hearkening back to a time when she had young children and thought that in the 1980s you had to be stern and punish the children in a way that they would remember. And she did that once and she was like, nah, it doesn't work. Like,
yeah, ground the kid for a month. Well, shit, I'm the one who's grounded because I have to be there to monitor. No,
and you can't change your mind after you grounded him for a month, because then it makes you look like a softy.
Well, no, I definitely changed my mind. I said, okay, well, you're going to do these chores instead, because, you know, I can't handle grounding you for a month. So,
and I mean, it really, that's almost like what actually is happening at City Hall. The counselors got together while they were angry. Well, at least one of them was angry. We know Shiloh was definitely on some kind of track.
The day after the August 21 shit show showdown, she filed the complaint. Like,
and
if I'm really,
it's alleged that she also barged into the mayor's office. We're gonna try and get the video on that through the FOIPs we're submitting. But if any of that is true, it would say to us that Shiloh was still pissed when this all went down, when this was submitted. And so if
any trigger warnings here, because I want to talk about Shiloh's behavior on Monday night, about her statements.
All right, I'm gonna throw that in the comments section. That on the live here, we're going to get into trigger warning, because we'll be talking about statements made publicly by Shiloh Sharps that involve not necessarily self-harm. She talks about will to live, and she uses disparaging language, I should say, maybe is the best way to open this with a trigger warning. She uses disparaging language in, I guess, what she later described as, like, basically she was saying it was a joke, you know? But it's very odd that she would have the opportunity to extend the meeting 15 minutes and allow the mayor to finish, you know, these very important legal and financial questions that she's asking. Shiloh Sharp does not have time for that. She's literally losing the will to live because she's been there working until 9 or 10 o'clock. Reminder, Kelly and I start working usually at about 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning. We worked a 12-hour plus shift the other day, and I was still up until 2 a.m. just buzzing on wine and a little bit of... what do you call it when you're so proud of your community that they finally engaged with something important to you and them? Just a feeling of pride kept me up editing a couple of videos, doing a couple of funnies. And I think we've been talking about this stuff here and what the meeting was like. We talked about how the mayor didn't have a lot of time left at the end. We talked about Canodal sounding a little, not so ready, I guess. Not sure how to say that one.
It's a learning curve to learn to sit as the chair of city council. And Mayor Clark went through that curve after being elected. And we had a very able city clerk who helped her through it. And, mm-hmm. you know, she was able to streamline the meetings, so you're not going to have these marathon sessions anymore. Mm-hmm. Well, now we're going to have rookies in the mayor's seat every 6 weeks. And this is going to be really painful. Because at most they're going to be chairing three council meetings, public council meetings, mm-hmm. and then another one takes over. Well, shit, you know, it's going to get really long-winded. Yeah. And I felt really sorry for the people that had to do the presentation the other night, because they're pretty much held hostage till 11 o'clock.
Right. The guy that came in from Strong Towns, basically, he's just like providing some update information about the meetings that's been had, and, like, you know, some of the success stories and stuff like that.
Let me correct you there a little bit. Sean Champagne is a senior planner with the city. He doesn't work for Strongtown.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, he's the go-between, basically. He's been sort of the overseeing what has been the project of Strongtowns on behalf of the city.
Kind of the lead of the Strongtowns approach in Medicine Hat, but he does not work for Strongtowns.
Yeah. And he's coming back to city council to give them basically what should have been a pretty short update presentation about what Strongtowns has achieved, you know, just some success stories, things like that.
And they're entering into the second year of their contract with Strongtowns, and I believe most of council has participated in workshops, and, you know, there's been numerous public opportunities to go and engage.
And that was really the thing that slowed everything down. Shyla Sharps keeps asking questions that are basically should have already been answered. It's like, Shyla, did you do any of your homework? I mean, you're asking questions that are literally in the FAQ on the front page of the website of the guy that you're of the organization that is presenting, you know, through Sean Champagne. And Sean Champagne is there. He's done all his homework. He's read the book. He's gone to the meetings. He said it's a good book, worth reading. It's only a couple hundred pages. The city councilors, I mean, it's like he's holding his breath and he's saying, guys, we had tons of public meetings you could have come to. Shyla, some of them were at McNally's bar, okay? Like, you could have come to these things, okay? You maybe could have had a couple of drinks while you were there and enjoyed yourself, but you didn't come.
This presentation was presented in one of the committee meetings. You know, she could have watched that too.
She could have watched the committee meeting. She could have gone to the library. They have 10 copies of the book there, okay? It's like, he's basically saying, you know, I have done every freaking possible thing, Shyla, and you're here months and months and months later saying, I couldn't find anybody to ask questions to. Are you a 15-minute city? What? At that question, he was basically at that point like, wait, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? That just is not, no. Just uploading here, I've got video. I've got a couple of videos. One of them was Knodal struggling last night. And I think that's one of the things we have to focus on. If they're going to say things like Shyla's going, okay, well, the only reason that we couldn't finish this meeting was because we switched around the agenda. Well, hold up, Shyla. I've got a couple of examples here of why this meeting was slow AF. Molasses slow. Maybe it's because you guys took the person who knows how to do things succinctly and efficiently, pushed her over to the side, you don't let her talk very often, you've switched out her position with a substitute teacher who basically is good at arts and crafts, but is supposed to be teaching complex calculus. And it ain't working. Knodal, it ain't working. I put this one up as members only at first. I'm going to make it public and premiere it right now on the YouTube channel. I call this one the Knodal Yodel with Interpretive Hand Dance. Politics is hard. So Knodal the other night was having a lot of trouble understanding the Robertson rules, but tried so hard. And while she was trying so hard, she was using her hands a lot. And using words that trying to what I would describe as trying to make herself sound more academic while fumbling over something that, quite honestly, she should probably understand at this point. Also, the way that she engages with Larry is a very interesting engagement. It's as if Larry is saying, no, okay,
this is the quickest
you should know the rules by
poop.
Now. Okay? The rules are pretty simple, all right? Like, I've explained them a couple times, but I'll help you out again. Here's the rules again. And Knodal's sort of like, am I allowed to do this? Am I allowed to do that? And just very seemingly insecure about what is happening. So I'm going to put that one on here. It's going to premiere in a minute. That one's on the YouTube channel now. And thank you so much to everybody out there who is a member. If you signed up as a member on the YouTube, for a couple bucks, every once in a while, you're going to get like exclusive content that we create. Maybe a interview that Kelly got down at Town Hall. Maybe it's, you know, some kind of interpretive hand dance edit that I've done. You know, you get those first so you can talk about them at the water cooler before anybody else can. Then, you know, we'll publish them a little while later, maybe the next day, maybe a couple days later. But yeah, if you want to be in on the exclusive and get news before everybody else, pay us. Okay? Like, we will die if we don't eat enough food and drink enough water. We're human just like the rest of y'all. And the shit that we do is not, like, we can't do it for free. It's impossible. So we do have some awesome advertisers on our website. This is the website, comtv.ca. We got iFix Technology. So if you busted your phone, if you dropped your laptop, or even, I don't know, maybe you got one of those diagnostical tools for your car, and you busted it somehow, the pins broke off in the ODB2 sensor because you were mad at your car and started kicking it. If that happened, I'm sure that Justin can help you out. I mean, he's fixed so many odd devices. iFix, they're the ones that fix technology. Check them out. Crust Pizza, they're over on the highway, like right as you come in. You know, you're off the number one right there as you come in towards like the hospital on the number one. It used to be a gas station a long time ago, I guess, but it's been taken over by a really cool fam, that does, pizza. They have a convenience store there. And I mean, they do burgers, they do pizza, all that stuff. Yarshenko and Heidinger. If you get accused of something in town here, let's say you're driving, and you got pulled over by the cops, and they're accusing you of all kinds of things. They're sniffing around in your car, and they got all kinds of quote unquote evidence that you've done maybe a crime or something like that. You know, if you've got questions about whether or not the things that you're accused of are possibly not real, and maybe you should just go free, I would say contact Yarshenko and Heidinger. That's my lawyer. You know, when I get arrested, I scream to my friends, Bob, call my lawyer, it's 527-3030. Call my lawyer, it's 527-3030. Cops putting their hands over my mouth and cuffing me and kicking me and throwing me in the back of the police car. And I'm saying, the trash panda, save the trash panda. Call my lawyer. Thanks so much to these advertisers. It's important that we have local advertisers, but it's also super important that people like you, the viewers out there, are able to chuck us a couple bucks. If you go on the Community TV website, you will be able to chuck us a couple bucks. It's easy. Sign up on the website. You can just, you know, use your credit card like buying anything else on the website. Or if you're, let's say you're on Facebook right now, you could just send us stars. That's the thing that you can do. It's like sending us a little bit of money. It's cool. Helps us out. Or you can send an e-transfer directly. That's also pretty awesome. I took that off the screen. I'll put the e-transfer thing back up on the screen here.
And also give us cash if you see us out in public. We're not proud. 5, 10, 20 bucks, whatever.
Yeah, I'm into it. If anybody's got you know, some way of supporting us that's their personal type of thing, we're into it. You know, whatever it is that you think is the best way to support independent local journalism. Let's say, for instance, you've got, I don't know, like you got some, I don't know, some old laptop maybe that, you know, it's still good. You just don't use it anymore, you know, but it's a really good laptop and it could be used. Maybe that might be something that Community TV could use every once in a while. You know, we're looking for contributors, just like the Sun City Sentinel. However, we're going to tell you who our contributors are. We're going to vet them. We're going to read their articles before they're posted, and we're going to make sure that it's not complete fucking malarkey. But it'd be nice if maybe we're able to bring somebody on and say, you know, here's a laptop, write us some articles, go take some photos, and we'll be able to inspect that, find out whether or not it's useful to the community, and provide you some more local perspectives on what's going on. I'm going to hit the pause on the mic. Let's mute our mics, Kelly, and we'll watch first the Allison Knodel Yodel, interpretive hand dance here. You have it up on your screen. You watching with me, Kelly?
That second, I understand process. Yeah, got it. So we can vote on second reading. That will give us the opportunity to tweak our discussion. Well, it'll get us. Is it not on the floor though, at this current point in time? Tweak.
Yes, Madam Chair. Second reading is what's before council right now.
Right.
There's no referral to a committee pending.
Okay.
That motion hasn't been made, or one that was defeated. To refer to admin. So now it's back to the original motion, moved and seconded, second reading sits before you right now.
So just to clarify, it is, and to hear what you've said, it is you're telling me it's an inappropriate time to make any recommendations or communicate with the city manager. I'm just clarifying. Is that what you're telling me? No? Okay. Okay, so we will vote on... Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry,
okay,
sorry,
no problem.
And Larry's got his button on there. Sorry. No, it's not, because you're referring it back to staff, so it's absolutely good and appropriate, and
okay.
We appreciate the feedback and going through the list to make sure
we're capturing
the essence of what council is directing us to do. So
perfect.
Absolutely appropriate. Thank
okay.
you.
Just wanted to
make sure everyone's heard.
Councillor Sharps?
And maybe I'm just dumb, and I'll take that, but I couldn't find a way to reach out and ask a question.
I think that was one of my favorite sound bites. I'm going to grab that one for the soundboard for sure. Shyla Sharps, quote, maybe I'm just dumb. I think there are certainly some people that might agree with that sentiment. I think it's possible, Shyla. We also had... there's a couple other videos.
Most people have no clue that in 2023, the best way to make money...
Not that one. Let's see. The other videos that we had just recently uploaded. And like I said, these are just like weird edits that I did late at night just to kind of get you interested in what people are saying down there at City Hall. The other one that I have is probably going to demonetize this video when I play it back. The video on YouTube upload is partially blocked, meaning that if you're in Russia, you can't watch the video. But it is completely ineligible for monetization. In other words, I can't get paid from YouTube off of this video because of its... there's a little bit of Johnny Cash live at Folsom Prison in there. And that's for good reason.
More fulsome discussion of it.
Let me just make sure that we get Robbins in there. They talk about Folsom... Folsom. They all want to have a more fulsome discussion. Kelly, is it a little bit weird that all of a sudden these people that are all hanging out with this one person, Ann Mitchell, are starting to talk like her? Am I way off the fucking rails when I say it seems like they're actually becoming hypnotized in some kind of a way?
Well, you don't pick up someone else's expressions without spending a lot of time with them.
Right? I mean, vernacular... that other people start repeating. And I notice it because I have weird ways of describing what's going on around me. I remember probably I'm trying to remember one. I know it's at the tip of my tongue right now. Okay, so my buddy Bob and I, we work on lots of different kinds of projects. We're fixing things, right? We're working on some motorcycles. We fix up Bob's Jeep. We got a million bikes to fix up. It's the Cycle Guild of Medicine Hat. Shouts out. For instance... we're both pointing at something, and it's like a part on a motorcycle. Like, what I just, like, if I couldn't think of the part name right away, I'd point at it, and I'd be like, the guy. I'd call it the guy, right? Like, fucking this guy's got to come off, this guy goes on, and then this guy switches around because we had that guy on backwards. And after about probably 6 months of knowing Bob, he started saying, oh, yeah, that guy's fucked up right there, right? So, yeah. But, I mean, it takes a good little while. It's almost like you have to hang out with people in a social situation and sort of shoot the shit with them. And then you sort of start getting so friendly that you go, you know what? I like the way you talk. I like the way you say things. I like the way that this sounds. I'm going to start saying that too. You know?
You don't... mannerisms or the speech mannerisms of people that you don't like.
That's true too. When people... Yeah, you know what? When I hear somebody that I think is a repulsive person for any reason, and they use some kind of term, like there are, for instance, street terms that people use when they're upset with something or the way that they might describe somebody that they don't like. And when I hear somebody of a really low IQ use a term, I think to myself, damn, did I ever use that term? Would I ever use that term? I don't think I want to say that anymore because that person sounds like really, really restarted saying that.
Okay, let's rephrase that low IQ because there's people that do not have a whole lot of intelligence who are very pleasant people and do the best they can with what they got. How about low emotional IQ?
Yeah, low emotional IQ, or I apologize. I will reword that if anybody out there was sort of offended, triggered, or interpreted that in some way, that I was trying to talk down or punch down at anybody who is, you know, challenged in any kind of way when it comes to, you know, academics. I think maybe what I was actually describing was people's moral compass. And sometimes people's moral compass, like yeah. mine, I am quite certain that it points north. And when I walk in a direction that is not so north, I got a lot of friends that'll point me back in that direction. Some people's moral compass is seemingly sitting next to a magnet that is a bag full of money. And no matter where you move that moral compass, the compass points towards the bags of money. It always does. And it's just like, they don't know that their moral compass is broken, I think. I think some of them really want to believe that they feel just fine about what's going on. Everything's cool. I'm just, you know, this is just how things were always done. We hear that a lot, right? This is just how things were always done. I'm not doing anything wrong. I'm just repeating
in
history.
I'm not trying to offend anybody and, you know, just calm down, right?
Right. Right. It's like being gaslit by the local politicians. Like they're literally telling you, you're a conspiracy theorist if you believe that the mayor didn't do anything wrong. Also, we can't tell you what she did wrong. We have to redact everything and it's private, secret, top secret information. But the mayor's there saying, no, it's not. All you guys have to do is vote on not having this redacted bullshit document that makes no sense at all. And they're all going, no, we can't because of privacy. No, no, no. It ain't privacy. It's shilacy. That's why you guys aren't letting it out. We know. We know. We're not stupid. We know, okay? So what I got here is a live performance by Ann Mitchell of the song Folsom Prison by Johnny Cash. We're going to talk about the word Folsom a little bit afterwards here. We're bringing out dictionaries from the 1700s. You know, we're just going right into alternate dimensions when it comes to describing what's happening here. So let us play back the Ann Mitchell Folsom Prison from Monday night's city council meeting. Muting the mics, and here we go. Let's take it away.
Have a more fulsome discussion of it. And maybe I'm just dumb, and I'll take that, but I couldn't find a way to reach out and ask a question.
And that's why they're not being brought forward, but I look forward to a more fulsome conversation about this. Thank you.
Okay, with that, we will...
I don't know when I'm stuck in Folsom Prison, and time keeps dragging on.
Let's just see here. We have reorganized, so bear with me for a second. Do, do, do. What number are we here? Mayor Clark, are you opposed in any way to providing the context of your request?
I am not, but I am opposed to me having to come to council and ask permission for information that I'm entitled to and any member of the public is entitled to, but I am happy to provide the background, and I would like to make a motion to complete this item, extending the meeting to 11:15.
And time keeps dragging on.
We do have one other item on the agenda, too. It's first reading of the...
Correct.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. No, I understand that. So we have 1 minute to second and approve the request. Otherwise, this will be postponed until the next open meeting.
And time keeps dragging on.
I'm not going to extend this meeting because I think that we've absolutely could have got this done today. And I'm losing the will to live.
And
that was a fun little edit.
First point there, then the. The public title to that information, but they wanted the mayor to ask for permission to get that information. That's
right. She's like, it's literally my job to get this information, discuss it publicly, and make sure that things are copacetic. I am not suggesting that the mayor or that the city manager, Ann Mitchell, has used her credit card to buy furniture for her home. I'm not suggesting that. I'm not saying that she's done the pecuniary. I'm just saying that we got to look into it and make that a regular thing that we do, because that's a responsible thing to do. We're paying this person $300,000 a year to manage our company, which is the CMOH, City of Medicine Hat.
And then her first year, she's spending $565,000 on City Hall.
Right.
Furnishings and fixture and equipment upgrades. Like, but no, it's not itemized. Just, okay, this is what I spent it on, $565,000.
Now,
we have no idea.
I was down there walking around the other day. Just walk around City Hall, right? You're allowed to go in the parking garage, walk through all the departments. There are some signs that say, like, employees only beyond this point. I'm not going to walk past those because, like, most of the time I know how to read and I can see the signs. Sometimes they're hard to find. But I'm not going in any place where, like, I'm not allowed to be. I'm just walking around and whatnot. And I found a whole bunch of brand new empty boxes of new, like, computer equipment. And then I saw, like, the whole entire, like, department of, what is it there? The Department of Planning and Development. It's just, like, totally all the desks are gone. It's, like, they're getting all new stuff. And I'm thinking, like, did the old computer monitors just stop working? I mean, as the guy that's paying for all this, the taxpayer, the ratepayer, the dude that is a homeowner and paying property taxes and keeping this city alive, the lifeblood, the voter, okay? I want to know, are your monitors broken and you had to get new ones because they burned out over time?
You know what? Information technology was on the CAO contingency fund. It's a new project. This is separate from the $565,000. It's $164,000 that was spent on hybrid collaboration technology and meeting rooms leveraging. Now, they've had some issues with people not being able to dial into meetings, like Shyla Sharp's at a council meeting before. We could see her picture on the screen. We couldn't see her live and apparently couldn't get her audio. So,
yeah. And it just so happened to be the day after basically the entire city started to engage with municipal politics because they heard that Shyla Sharps made a complaint that got the mayor cut. They're all interested to know, Shyla, what's going on. And then all of a sudden, the next meeting, Shyla's not there in person. She dials in on the phone and there's some kind of problem. Dude, I never have any problems. You and I log into the WebEx all the time and friggin' Microsoft Teams and all the different softwares they use. There's no problem at all. It works just fine. And they bought it like during COVID. Like, it's not even old computer technology. This is like something that they invested lots of money in very recently. Anyways, I'm walking through City Hall. I see they got all these 24-inch monitors, like the empty boxes for the Dell monitors. Like, okay, yeah, it's only a $200 monitor. But like, if I'm your daddy, all right, and you got a 20-inch monitor and you got a perfectly good gaming system, you're playing your favorite Call of Duty, all right, and you just say, Dad, I want a 24-inch monitor because it's bigger and flatter.
The hell is buying Dell these days?
Idiots? I don't know. Dell is like the Walmart product of products. I mean, literally, you can buy the product that they had at Walmart. So I don't know if they went to Walmart, but I'm guessing they contacted Dell directly and said, ship us 20 of these monitors. We're upgrading the entire, you know, fleet. That's typically what happens. I mean, I used to work for Hewlett-Packard Small Business Development, and I would deal with cities, municipalities in the United States and sell them computer technology. And when they get a contract to upgrade something, they don't fix Bob's computer. They go, okay, we got 20 people in this staff area. 12 of them have computers. We need 12 computers, 12 monitors, 12 new mouse, 12 new keyboard. Just replace the whole entire thing. And what do we do with the old stuff? Fucking throw it away. It's 3 years old. I mean, God, what are we working with? Like, ugh. You know, so it's just interesting to me that our city is doing so well financially that they have the ability to just throw away a bunch of computers and buy a bunch of brand new flat screens. But they got to jack the property tax rate. They definitely have to do that. That is without question. They must get more money from each individual taxpayer, you know, so that they can sustain what's going on here. Even though they're making 49 million extra dollars a year on fucking selling a little bit of gas and electricity. Seems preposterous, but go ahead, Kelly. I've got one other video that I was going to play. Is there anything else we're missing off of talking about Knodel's Yodel or and Mitchell in Folsom Prison? Oh, Folsom, yes.
Folsom,
definitions,
yes,
of the word Folsom. Let's start with that. What is the underlying message when these city councilors are repeating the same language that we hear Ann Mitchell use? Folsom.
Now, I heard the word and I recognized it, but Tom didn't because, well, I read a lot of old books and stuff, and the word has come up in a few things. So F-U-L-S-O-M-E. Now, if you look up the definitions, I think they used the word, we want a more fulsome discussion. I think they wanted to use it in a way that meant we want to have a longer discussion, you know, a more detailed. But we looked up the definitions, and fulsome is not really a good word to use. One definition from Oxford Languages says complimentary or flattering to an excessive degree. And then the other one, of large size or quantity, generous or abundant. So a fulsome harvest. Dictionary.com, I like this one. It's an adjective. Definition one, offensive to good taste, especially as being excessive, overdone, or gross. Such as fulsome praise that embarrassed her deeply, fulsome decor. I wonder if the new decor at City Hall is fulsome. The second definition is disgusting, sickening, repulsive, as in a table heaped with fulsome mounds of greasy foods.
Greasy? Like oily?
Like the oil that was on the beach in Sioux Lookout, Ontario, where Ann Mitchell was city manager there, CAO, whatever her title was.
It's so funny and interesting that when somebody uses smarmy language, they paint themselves with a certain kind of brush. And the paint that they're using happens to not be so water-based. Oily, I might say. Ann Mitchell paints herself oily when she uses the language fulsome and has her other devotees repeat that language in a cult-like way, or maybe even like a queen would have her serfs, servants, and what do we call these people who serve the queen?
Courtiers.
Her courtier. In the courtyard of the queen, thou shalt repeat the messaging that is found in Ann Mitchell's podcast. she's got this word fulsome. She uses it in a smarmy way, and it actually paints her as oily. Funny thing, her last job was the city manager of a town, a little town called Sioux Lookout over in Ontario, where for 4 years straight, the beach was closed because there was an oily substance all over the beach. And Ann Mitchell told everybody, well, don't worry about it. It's just some kind of algae. I don't know. I need to talk to Halady, which is the man who independently did research over there and claims that this is a petrochemical-like oily sheen that was on the beach. He says, or alleges, that it could have been caused by a development that was happening close to the beach where large mechanical diesel-type machines were being used to, you know, move dirt and build things, and that could have been where that stuff came from, you know? And we're here talking about, you know, pecuniary interests of people in positions of power, and it's possible that in a small town like Sioux Lookout, a big developer gets a project and it's next to the water, and they go, okay, I mean, we're going to get these condos out at $1 million each. Let us make $1 billion off this thing. However, whoops, by a mistake, we had one of our diesels spring a leak, I don't know what we did. We spilt diesel. It went into the water. And we're either going to have to pay a huge environmental reclamation and apologize to everybody, or we could maybe, possibly, I'm just saying that this is a possible thing that could happen. A big oil company could pay off a little small town, little city manager to create a complete campaign of misinformation for 4 years so that nobody in town can go to the friggin' beach and just tell them that it's like, oh, it's actually, it's just some kind of algae. Like, you can't swim in it because the algae's dangerous, but it's not an oil spill. We didn't do that. And then just at the end of her career, she just says, oh, you know, like, I got to go somewhere else for another job. Thanks for the time. Bye. You know, what's going on over there now? Are people swimming at the beach now? I want anybody in Sioux Lookout, anybody who knows people in Sioux Lookout, contact Trash Panda. We can keep your information, your personal private information, completely secret. What we want is tips that will allow us to tell the story about what's going on with this beach, because it's sus as fuck.
And we should note that tourism is a big thing in that tiny little town, and the beach is a big attraction. So, I mean, if your beach is out of commission, well, you're screwed to get the vacationers, right?
I want to reinforce that I have always believed Medicine Hat is part of, and now is officially part of, a tourism hub of Southern Alberta. Our water here is extremely important to adventure tourism. There's lots of people that are getting into paddle boarding, canoeing, kayaking, fly fishing, all sorts of water-related outdoor activities. And if Medicine Hat fails to develop a plan or an advertising campaign that revolves around the beauty of our valley, the cycling, the all of the summer-related adventure tourism things that can be done here, climbing, trails, even just going to fly drones in really remote places, really cool stuff that can be done around here. And the city has never really promoted it as a hub for adventure tourism. They have always said, this is a great place to move and raise a family. It's a great place to retire, and taxes are low and utilities are low. Well, now that's not true anymore, okay? Taxes aren't really super low. I mean, for where we are and what we get, it's not that great of a deal anymore. And in terms of utilities, crazy. I mean, for a little while there, I was thinking, I'm going to have to figure out some way to start, I don't know, stealing electricity off the city. Friggin' back in the day when we were illegal growing pot, you know what I mean? You just climb up the friggin' telephone pole, hook on your wires, all dangerous. Front climb back down, son of a bitch, oh, the cops don't see you, to put the electrical tape all over the wires. I was thinking I was gonna have to freaking climb the pole and steal the shit. Y'all are saying, like, I bet that's terrible, Tommy. I can't believe you were thinking that. It's like, yeah, well, you're not in the desperate position that I'm in to get some freaking electricity, maybe. But the shit costs so much more all of a sudden. I mean, I'd see people that lived here their whole life, old people. They got their, you know what I mean, old people that keep every piece of paper in a filing cabinet in the basement of their home, going down to the basement and pulling out their friggin' utility bill from 1956. And they're like, yo, look, in Medicine Hat in 1956, I paid $1.76 for all services. Fucking the most expensive one on there was sewer. It was 37 cents for me to get the sewer. You know what I mean? And now it's just like, it does not keep up with inflation at all. Like, what's happening is the super inflation of utilities and costs, along with new administrative costs that just come out of nowhere. So if you only take the percentage of cost of the gas and the electricity, maybe it's along the lines of 17% or whatever they say inflation has been over time. But if you add in all these new administration costs and all these new, it's like, it's getting easier for them to do. Like back in the day in 1956, a lady was sitting at a typewriter typing out every single goddamn bill at you owe $1.37. Print that out, put it in an envelope, lick the envelope, send it. That was a lot of work. Nowadays, you sign up for electronic billing, you forget everything's automated. Why are they charging us administration fees? The system's been paid for. Those computers have been running for years. We don't need to replace the hard drives or buy new friggin' screens for them, IT department. I'm calling you out, IT department. You know you're sitting there with brand new friggin' screens. Like, I got my new screen. Look, we all paid for that, all right? Shame on you. Shame on you. That 17-inch monitor from Acer in 1997 still works. And you don't need 1080p. What are you doing, watching YouTube videos at work? We are going to do a FOIP on all of the IP traffic going on at City Hall. And if it's watching YouTube videos, guess what? We're going to find out which YouTube videos you're watching. We're going to find out what office you're in. And we're going to go, look, people of Medicine Hat, it appears as if the people who are in this new $565,000 security outfit for the city are sitting there watching YouTube videos all day. We're going to find out. We are going to find out. I guarantee you.
Do you have the one with Shiloh's remarks at the end of the night?
The future of your business
and
sorry, I had my mic on mute. I'm so sorry. I had my mic on mute for a second there, guys. I am back. We are talking about how Shiloh Sharps wasted a whole bunch of time yammering on about catalogs. Well, the mayor only got a few minutes at the very end, and they cut her off, and nobody seconded her motion to have 15 more minutes. Shiloh did have the time to go to ChatTV and try and explain herself and bullshit answers, but what I'm trying to depict here is that during the Strong Towns presentation, Shiloh wasted a lot of time, and that is what contributed to the mayor not having enough time to do her Democratic dissertation in a minute and 30 seconds, which is basically what they gave her. I'm going to play this one back here. It's only a minute long, but it is an example of Shiloh just wasting time during the meeting and sounding so silly. This is the edit that I call Sean Explains Catalog. Also, 15-minute cities they're negotiating now, okay? They're gonna go maybe up to 15 minutes if people agree, but they have settled at 17 minutes and 27 seconds. So, anybody out there who's afraid of 15-minute cities, thinks this is some kind of a big deal, don't worry about it, okay? They're negotiating. They're willing to settle at 17 minutes and 27 seconds, folks. That's a pretty good number. But Shiloh Sharp says she likes a half hour, I think, or 40 minutes or something like that. She said something about I like to live far away from people because I don't like people. I don't even like to see them. What I like to do is, and I don't know if I'm quoting her properly or not. This might be a misquote, but she said something along the lines of, I like to live in a $4 million mansion that is several kilometers from the plebs, the dirty people who live in the city, because I like the fact that my six-cylinder 2.3-liter Mercedes-Benz can just spend lots of gas money heading to city because I use my P card for the gas money anyway. That's ostensibly what she was saying, I think. She doesn't like the dirty plebs. She likes to live in a mansion out of town, and she's got so much money that it doesn't matter how long she's got to drive her Mercedes to get there. To anybody who's pissed that I keep saying that she drives a Mercedes, I drive a Porsche sometimes when it works, if I can fix it. But hers is on a lease. I own mine. All right. Let's get to the time waster here. This is the catalog meme. I'm going to mute my mic for a second. I'll bring it back.
Development and Infrastructure Committee. We have Sean Champagne, Senior Planner, here to provide a presentation to us. And I will turn the torch over to you.
Wonderful. So thank you, everyone. Thanks for having me here this evening. I'm very happy to be here to provide this catalog. It comes, and we do eventually have this catalog.
Is that like the Sears catalog of like garages?
Okay. Yes, it's essentially that. It would be a catalog. So we want to eventually have a catalog of, could flip through and say, I want this.
Wow, that sounds very awesome.
Catalog.
It's the catalog.
I'm not sure if this might interest you, but people ask me.
My buddy Bob is now interested to find out what this catalog is all about. Basically, it's kind of cool, actually. It might even be useful. The city of Medicine Hat wants people to have more secondary units available, more rental units. They want to basically have more housing, but not have to build a bunch of big apartment buildings and stuff. And the people from Strong Towns got together and had some meetings about, like, you know, how can we make it easier for people to build something or expand on something that they currently have and make it so that they can have, you know, a couple of rental units. And what they came up with, the people, just some random folks from Medicine Hat that were sitting around, you know, having some drinks and some nachos, were like, okay, what if we, like, went through a list of all the things that have been approved already for backyards, like garages or garages that have a little unit in them, like a kitchen, bathroom, rental unit. If they have a bunch of these that have already been approved, we can make it like a fucking like a Lego catalog, right? And you could just go through and it says $145 this permit right here. You print everything out, you go to a contractor, you say, hey, I want garage number one, I want in-law suite number four, I want XYZ, and they just friggin' build it right from the plans. And you know that the permit's good, you know everything's good, the city inspector comes, he says, I've seen these before, we're good to go. I mean, I am not the type of person that wants to live in a Lego world myself. And I know that's what's going on. In the future, all houses are just going to look exactly the same. They're going to be mirror images of each other.
But Tom, after the war, there were a lot of houses that looked very much the same. And so I think a lot of those were like pre-approved plans because they wanted to build a bunch of housing very quickly. So, okay, you want to build a house? Here's some plans. Pick one and you can get to work right away. Otherwise, you have to come up with a plan. We have to approve it, make sure it's structurally sound, and that's going to delay you. So. A lot of homes, I mean, some of the newer homes look like cookie cutter homes, for crying out loud. They all look absolutely the same.
Yeah, you go to any of the new developments in Medicine Hat, and it's literally like there's home A, B, or C. They all look the same. And then there's home A mirrored, B mirrored, and C mirrored. And you just see them next to each other. You go down the street, and it's like, we fucking live in a simulation for sure. You know what I mean? Like, it's too obvious when you see those neighborhoods that just look like they were generated by The Sims. But, you know, like I said, I'm not a person to want that cookie cutter village. I mean, I love living in a part of town that has unique looking, you know, I love downtown. I love the River Flats area. I love the Riverside area. You know, there's a lot of old buildings that have character. They look great. They could maybe use a little bit of development. Some of them could, for sure, take down the shitty old garage that's in the backyard that was built with no standards whatsoever by Uncle Jim in 1950. They could probably stand to bulldoze a few of those in some of the older neighborhoods, especially where there was flooding damage, and probably build these newer structures. And it's a lot like those old Sears catalogs. I mean, back in the 19... I'm guessing this is pre-Depression? Or was it post-Depression? I think it was post-Depression.
Depression, I think. Yeah. You know, maybe in 1930s? Yeah, you could buy a house to build it.
There were literally catalogs where you just flip through. It would show an image of a house. It would say, this is a three-bedroom. It would show you a layout and blueprints. It would say, you need 9,000 2x4s. You need, like, 900, you know, 8x8s.
It wasn't just the plan. They would ship you the entire house.
Yeah, it would come on, strapped on basically a back of a train. You'd pull up, you'd take the thing off, put it on your truck or your transporter, your trailer. You'd bring it back to the property that you bought. Hopefully you'd have your cement poured by then and you'd be ready to start building. You and every brother and cousin within the Prairie Range that could be contacted via, Morse code, letters, telephony, or possibly running man, person on the train. Everybody would come get together and they would hoist the friggin' thing together. They put together the frame. They just prop it up. A hand-built home, likely with hammers and nails that are, some of these nails that these houses were built with were literally just forged with a little mold that they made out of a rock, with something where they would just pour metal in to make these little sharp impressions and slam them in. These are things that were built super high quality, but just out of a catalog, right?
Yeah, topic again.
Yeah. So these catalogs basically, you'd be able to build something cool in your backyard, real cheap and easy. It's a good idea Strong Towns came up with. Shiloh Sharps, after that, basically starts to get into conspiracy theories. She goes on about, is this 15-minute cities? And the guy is like, did you read the FAQ on our website? Like,
John would not do that. No. He is much more polite and much more diplomatic.
Right. I am the asshole, remember. I am just interpreting it my own way. But in an academic way, he went through the list of all of the different resources that have been available for several months, explaining to Councillor Sharps, through the chair, of course, that there are all kinds of ways that you could have asked any of these questions prior to right now, but I will do my best to answer them. And in doing his best to answer them, I don't think that Sean was necessarily aware of how time was being used against Mayor Clark at that very moment. I don't think he was aware. I mean, they had run this guy to exhaustion. He came to the freaking meeting at like 6 o'clock, right? He's been at work all day too. He's a 9-to-5, right? So he probably got off work, went to get some supper downtown, came back to City Hall. He's sitting there for friggin' a 12-hour shift at this point.
Well, and now I just lost my train of thought.
Sorry. Sean. Sean Champagne.
No, I've talked to him numerous times. He's such a nice guy, such a patient guy, and he will go through every little detail. He'll go over and over and over. Well, he has small children, so he's used to dealing with people who don't understand.
Oh, this is...
Normally, when they have presentations on the agenda, no matter where the presentation is on the agenda, they will say, well, we're keeping these people. We want them to be able to go home. Let's move the presentation up. But they held them there till 11 o'clock, which is unbelievably disrespectful to our city staff, because he's got a family. He's got small children. He doesn't need this shit, really.
Okay. Other thing I will say.
I happen to know he's a nice guy. And
not only is he a nice guy in the we've met him tangentially on the we professionally deal with him through the city and through Strong Towns, where Kelly, I guess, to disclose all possible pecuniary interests, Kelly spends a whole bunch of her volunteer time down there brainstorming with these folks because she loves the city and she wants it to grow in a way that makes sense. She wants it to grow in a way that is community minded and looks out for those that are in vulnerable positions. And those
I don't brainstorm with the city. I brainstorm with our local conversations group. And sometimes city members will show up and they'll listen to our ideas, but they don't really have any input into what we do.
Now,
so
Also, I have to disclose, Sean Champagne, okay? Maybe I have a pecuniary interest in saying that he's a good guy because he also supported the Cycle Guild of Medicine Hat. You know, not through monetary donation. This guy is a cyclist himself. He lives it and breathes it. In fact, I think, I could give away personal information, but I think he is the most cycled to work person in the whole entire building. I can almost guarantee, I challenge anybody else to put kilometers on like Sean Champagne is putting kilometers on. You know what I mean? He's going through tires. I don't know anybody else on city council, discluding the mayor, who actually uses a bike enough to go through tires. Because I will say, the mayor does use the bike enough to go through tires. She appeared 3 years ago at the grand opening of the Cycle Guild and donated her personal bike from her teenage years. As I remember, it was a pink 24-inch super cycle step-over frame with 21 gears on it. That's 7 in the back, 3 in the front. It had a cantilever brake in the back. It had a side pull brake in the front. It's a beautiful bike. Honestly, beautiful paint job on that bike. Back in the 80s, they used to do marbling and speckling on the frame and stuff. Mayor Lindsay Clark came in to the Cycle Guild on its grand opening and donated her childhood bike. I'ma tell ya, the tires were they needed replacement to get back out on the road. Mayor Clark at one time was truly a cyclist and lived it and breathed it. So there are some cyclists down there, and I just wanted to, like, as I'm saying, you know, maybe using Sean Champagne's personality through my own oration to make fun of Councillor Shyla Sharps for wasting time and asking silly questions. In my opinion, if I was there, if I was Sean Champagne and I wasn't able to hold back, I would have been saying stuff like, come on, lady. It was all there for you. You had the opportunity to look. What are we doing here? I'm not wasting any more time with this. Let's move on to the next. But Sean's a very polite man, as you said. And with being polite, sometimes that can be exploited. And if somebody knows that the politeness and niceties can take another 5-10 minutes, well, that's 5-10 minutes that we're stealing from Mayor Lindsay Clark.
An age where I just don't give a shit anymore. So I will tell people, you know, shut the hell up. But yeah,
I've had people come to my property to serve me documents, right? Like I'm getting sued or something like that. They're all bullshit. But this person one time came up and they just started shooting the shit with me about bicycles while I was working on something in my backyard in my garage. And so I started trying to do the niceties with this person. And after about 2 minutes, I was like, you know what? F this. What the F do you want? Like, get out of here. Like, I don't have time for your stupid questions. So, sometimes my fuse runs short. It probably depends how much coffee, caffeine, THC, and food in my belly. You know, if I get hangry, I'll start using big words that I don't think you understand while I talk down to you. I punch down academically when I get hangry. But also, academics can be a bit of an asshole. Sometimes you know so much that you're just exhausted and you're like, listen, this is what's fucking going on. I'm going to tell you straight. I don't have time for the niceties. Shyla Sharps knew that she could steal time away from the mayor by catalog niceties. Let's go back to Sears. Fuck that shit. This is what the mayor had to say. We had to wait 4 hours, 28 minutes and 34 seconds. It's like they lit the fuse at the start and they all knew we're going to let it blow up in the mayor's face and make her look silly. We're going to let the crickets chirp while she looks for a second motion on having 15 more.
Also mentioned that the mayor wanted this put on the March 4 agenda and it never got put on. So.
March. Think of that. March 4th. There was another meeting after March 4th.
Yeah.
April. We have another meeting in April.
Yeah.
Like, not only are they putting her off to the very last second in this particular meeting, they put her off already for 2 council meetings. And she is not asking for some kind of investigation performed by $1 million, third party, uninterested contractual. No, She's simply asking for her employee to bring her the receipt.
Yeah.
That's part of the job. Like, it's like if I, for instance, Kelly is contracted to work for my company and there are things that we have agreed she will do, right? If she just didn't do those things for a long period of time and then came to me and was like, yo, I need $800. I'd be like, for what? Like Kelly, like it's been a year and you haven't written anything on the website. We want $800. What did you do? And Kelly says to me, listen, I am not going to write anything or do any work or provide you any evidence of any work that I've done or any money that I've spent. And you have to give me this $800. You have to. Like, you just have to. And I'm like, okay, listen, I don't know if I have to or not. I'm pretty sure I'm the boss. I'm pretty sure that I only pay people when they work on stuff, like, and do actual work. But also, you had the company phone, right? And I looked at the TELUS bill. Kelly, this is all, of course, a big joke that I am telling that makes people understand the metaphor. I'm going, Kelly, in this metaphorical world that is me comparing my company, of course, hiring Kelly, to the city council and how the mayor would react to her employee, Ann Mitchell. I say, Kelly, I also gave you that cell phone and I pay the bill on the cell phone. It's actually connected to my credit card. There's no way I can get away from paying that bill. It has to get paid. But it says that your last three phone bills were $1,000. Kelly, I need to know. I know that you've been doing a lot of investigations. I know sometimes you need to make a long distance call. Okay, like, I understand that sometimes on your phone you're using data. Maybe you gotta watch some YouTube videos. Kelly, I think I gave you 20 gigs of data a month, okay? Like, you went over the 20 gigs of data and spent an additional $1,000 on data? Kelly, I don't know how you did that. Did you download apps that cost money and go in the app store and just build the things? Like, I cannot afford for you to be using, like, are you using those gambling apps? Listen, look, I know that you've been around some people in your life that are kind of like maybe the questionable connections from your past, and those people maybe had gambling problems. Did you leave your phone with somebody who's got a gambling problem and let them download a gambling app that charges directly to the TELUS cell phone bill? These are the questions I have for my employee, okay? But I can find out by asking the simple question of, Kelly, you know, I could just call TELUS and they will just send me the bill or whatever, right? But I know that you actually get the paper copy sent right to your office. Can you just bring me that paper copy to our next meeting on March 4th? Kelly knows, right? She's nodding her head yes without even thinking. This is a completely made up situation, which would likely never happen because Kelly knows how to use a phone and doesn't want to make me indebted to a credit card in some kind of way. But it seems like a conversation that could easily happen at any business. Kelly, I gave you the cell phone. The cell phone bill is supposed to be $65 a month. It's $1,000. You got to explain that somehow. You bring your paperwork because I know I can get it. And that's what the mayor is essentially saying. She's saying, any person in the public could FOIP this. Why are you not bringing me the receipts? Like, what did you do, Kelly? All I wanted to know was why the $1,000 was spent. And I'm going to be honest, we're doing a lot better in advertising. I mean, I'm not really all that concerned. I think we could pay one of those $1,000 bills, but I'm going to contact TELUS and I'm going to argue the bill down because you can't have $1,000 overages. I mean, that just doesn't make sense. But we're going to do our best to work with you, Kelly, if you just be honest and bring us the bill and tell us what went on. And imagine Kelly's response being, I don't have to fucking bring the friggin' TELUS bill down here. You gave me that cell phone, and that means that I can use it for whatever I want. Even if I want to turn the cell phone into a Bitcoin credit card and buy my groceries with it. And I'm like, wait, well, what? You turned the phone into a Bitcoin credit card and did what?
And you know what? Council gave the city manager a blank check. She's gets $1 million a year with the CAO contingency fund. She doesn't have to ask anybody's permission on what she can spend it on.
Kelly, imagine if I gave you a Visa that had, I'm going to say, like $5,000 a day spending limit, like with no question whatsoever. Probably like 20 grand, you got to call in some phone number and verify that you're you. And I don't mean call your boss. I mean call the bank, right? Your boss will maybe see this 6 months later at like a quarterly meeting where we go through most of the numbers, and your 5,000 honestly is going to look like a drop in the bucket when we compare it to the millions and millions that were spent. Kelly, what is the first thing you buy with Tom's unlimited credit card?
Parts for my bike.
Okay. Reasonable. I mean, I would have thought maybe the Blue Bullet will be in there as well. We'll keep the Blue Bullet running. We'll get maybe a backup engine.
Then, so I'd rather ride than drive if I can, because it's better on gas, right? So
it's nights out right now, right? Kelly, spend your money wisely. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
$1 million a year. Works out for 365 days, a little over $2,700 a day.
So, guys, even Kelly, the most righteous of the Unholy Alliance, she went right in the gutter when I gave her $1 million. She was like, my fucking Harley! Let's go for a ride! Her mind went right in the gutter. Honestly, I thought for a split second, that you were going to kind of like, you were going to do a Jedi mind trick on me, and you were going to go, fuck, $27,000 a day, Tom? We're going down to that FOIP office, and we're just dropping thousands in cash at the FOIP office. We're dancing around. We're throwing $100 bills at the FOIP people. Give us the documents, bitches. Do it. Give us them documents. And I thought that'd be funny as hell, man. If we win the lottery, just going down to the FOIP office in Medicine Hat and just throwing hundreds around, like drinking champagne in there and making movies, getting on TikTok and acting like complete weirdos. Yeah, we're rich. Let's find out what they stole.
Into that.
We'll get into
it. To the extent that the information does include personal information or financial information of a third party, this information could be redacted in accordance with the Freedom of Information and Protection of Privacy Act.
Thank you, Mayor Clark. The one thing I want to make known is, as we continue forward, we cannot continue past 11 without a motion to continue past 11. So we will need a motion to continue this conversation. Oh, yes, of course. Councillor Robbins.
Yeah, sorry, I'm not making a motion to stay past 11, just in case anyone was muttering about why, if I would. I'm not going to. Mayor Clark, it's clear to me that you've read from material, and I know when I did a notice of motion, I provided material to council in advance so we could review the two notices of motions I had and the background and why I was requesting them. I'm wondering if you could provide us the written information that you've prepared, and that will be give us, at least me, I can't speak for everybody else, at least it would give me a better opportunity to respond and think about what your request is. So if that could be provided, it would be very, very helpful for me to understand better and have a more fulsome discussion of it.
Mayor Clark, are you opposed in any way to providing the context of your request?
I am not, but I am opposed to me having to come to council and ask permission for information that I'm entitled to and any member of the public is entitled to, but I am happy to provide the background, and I would like to make a motion to complete this item, extending the meeting to 11:15.
We do have one other item on the agenda too. It's first reading of the...
Correct.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. No, I understand that. So we have 1 minute to second and approve the request. Otherwise, this will be postponed until the next open meeting. Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. I just wanted to say, to be honest, I think we would have got this completed, but we moved the agenda around. Mm-hmm. So I don't think there's anybody's intention, but I'm not going to extend this meeting because I think that we've absolutely could have got this done today. But we chose to move the agenda, so there's, in all fairness, there's just consequences to that. And I can't literally have a good conversation anymore, any longer. So I have a responsibility while I'm sitting at this table to be somewhat coherent, and I'm losing the will to live. So, no.
Point of order, it's 11.
Okay, yes, go ahead quickly.
And just then one quick question too. I would like an opportunity to respond. Some of the things really clearly fall under the purview of the city manager, and that's why they're not being brought forward. But I look forward to a more fulsome conversation about this. Thank you.
Okay, with that, we will, do we have to vote on postponing these items, or do they naturally get postponed? Okay, so these items will be discussed. I would recommend the being some of the first items on the next open agenda so that we can deal with them immediately. And with no further business, we will adjourn the meeting.
Did we want to go back a little further? Was there anything that was the very end of?
Yeah, we're going any particular direction. We were
was
saying
there
that
anything time code wise that we wanted to get to that was right before that.
Not at this time. I wanted to address Shyla's comments. I don't think she was trying to deliberately be offensive. You know, I met her during the 2021 civic election. And, you know, I knew she was a bit of abrasive, not always politically correct. And, you know, she does say the wrong words. But, you know, they did have a public relations advisor on staff, and then they fired the person. And this, and so when she apologized, and this is, I don't call this an apology, because it's not the way that you apologize. When you apologize, you admit that you've done something wrong.
And you get up your ukulele and you sing it.
You know, I'm sorry that anyone was offended. Well, that's not how you apologize. You said something that was very hurtful. You know, my own family has had people lost to suicide. One was, you know, a couple decades ago, and then another a couple of years ago, and a young person. And then, you know, not very long after, this young person's best friend was also lost to suicide. And there's people hurting in this city. And what she said, you know, and losing the will to live, you know, people are either, they were either outraged by her insensitivity, or they were concerned about her mental health, because, you know, counsel's been taken.
I would say that I fell into both camps. When I think about, you know, me contracting this wonderful work that you like to do in researching municipal politics and in attending things that are of interest to you. And that in the past, there has been opportunities for you to actually, and go back in the videos, folks that are watching, search out Kelly's presentation to the police commission that happened last year. To a certain extent, it makes me so proud that Kelly is able to tell her story and that she has the platform to inform people about things that she's gone through and ways that we can improve our community. Kelly, it breaks my heart when I see that you become very involved in something, pour out your heart and soul into that thing to people that you really think, these people will recognize what I'm saying, act on it. They will change, maybe if just the very least, they will change the language they use in their life. I don't want people to say they committed S. I don't want people to say that, because that's like looking at the thing like it's a crime. You commit felonies, yeah. You commit perjury, you commit assault. You don't commit self-harm.
You know what?
Self-harm is something that happens because of illness. Yeah. Self-harm is something that happens because of desperation. Self-harm is something that happens because of unfulfilled hunger. It kind of looks like Shyla's hungers are all pretty well fulfilled. So when she says something like, I'm losing the will to live, what she's actually saying is, I'm losing the will to be here in this slightly uncomfortable chair in a room where people are looking at me, because I don't like people. I don't like looking at people. I don't like people looking at me. I don't like interacting with people. I like being in my mansion with my dogs, kicking my feet up, drinking wine, watching Netflix. Hey, Shyla, I like that too. That's why I'm an independent journalist, okay? I ran for city, I ran for mayor as a freaking joke so I could figure out how all is happening there. And I know what's going on there. It's a clearly rigged system. And if you do get in, they rig you. I don't know who they are, but they got money. And they seem like they're old, like elders.
I just want to point out that when I spoke to the police commission, Shyla Sharps was on the police commission there at that time. And she saw how emotional I got. And she actually messaged me and asked if I was okay at the time. And to just have her say that sort of thing now was astounding. Like, my jaw pretty much dropped when that happened. And I think she needs to do a much better apology and maybe spend some time with some mental health people to understand what all of this is all about. Because, you know, fine, if you're a private person, you can say whatever the hell you want, but you're in public now. You're a public figure. You're at a public meeting, and more people are getting involved in council meetings, which Shyla Sharks wanted because she would get so mad. Well, you didn't watch the meeting. Well, okay, we're watching the meeting. You're saying something really disturbing and offensive, and you need to do a better job apologizing. Maybe you should go and hire back that public relations advisor, because right now you guys could use it to kind of calm the shitstorm a little bit. Like, unbelievable.
It was alleged that during the recess of the shit show showdown on August 21st, that it is alleged by the mayor that Shyla Sharps and Cassie Hyder came over to her desk, Mayor Lindsay Clark's desk, when she used to sit at the head of the shoe there. That horseshoe is set up in a way that the person who speaks for the city is at the center. And that's where Mayor Clark alleges she remained during this recess. Now, it is alleged also by the mayor and her lawyer that after leaving the room, Shyla Sharps and Cassie came back into the room and basically surrounded her. Shyla Sharps sitting at the chair to her right, which I think was McGrogan's chair, and Cassie Hyder, I can't say towering over her because Cassie Hyder is very short, but Cassie Hyder standing next to her, likely at possibly just eye level, leaning over and said to Mayor Clark, it is alleged that they basically gaslit Mayor Clark, saying something along the lines of, we don't think you are well.
Okay. And being unstable.
Unstable.
And emotional.
Emotional. Now, I have never seen Mayor Lindsay Clark use language so extreme, even in jest, in public, in any manner, not only in city council, but also in public, to say something like, oh, because of the long hours of work, I no longer have the will to live. Because Lindsay Clark, I think, is informed enough to know that that could and would offend people, that it is a rude thing to say, it's a crude thing to say, it's unprofessional, it denotes that somebody, and this is not Shyla slipping up once, she said it twice during this meeting alone. I think it's a phrase that she uses quite literally very often. And she uses the terms, things like quite literally. She uses terms like, there are certain terms that if you start paying attention, and I urge you folks out there who have a little extra time on your hands, start paying attention like Kelly and I are paying attention. You might think, you might have heard, somebody might have told you, oh, that Toby Tommy guy, he's crazy. He's a nutcase. Oh, yeah, he's a nutcase, man. He gets arrested all the time. Nutcase. All right. Maybe I'm nuts. But if you start looking at the stuff me and Kelly are looking at, you're going to go crazy, too. And you're going to go, where is my money going? What is happening here? Is this town turning into a goddamn pirate ship? Or is it a, or has a queen come in and usurped all power? What is happening?
And another thing that Shyla said, which was rather offensive when she's explaining to, you know, the other news organization here in the hat, she says, I would like everyone to just calm down a little bit and look at people's intentions. You know what happened to the last person who tried to tell me to calm down? One time, this guy mouthed off and told me to take a chill pill. So I told him off. And then, my husband, Carl, he's, you know, talking to the guy. Hey, you want to come on over and hang out? Guy says, well, is your old lady there? He says, nope. He made sure that I was not there because I was so unpleasant. So you don't want to piss me off. You don't want to tell me to calm down. That's a last bloody thing you ever want to say. Oh. I mean, I could have got in on the interview, but I was beat and I wasn't going to do a good job. And, you know, I know Eli, he's going to do a good job. So.
Questions. I needed to unmute my mic there. Back on with you here. You know, when somebody like Shyla Sharp says, I'm at work here, I'm exhausted, I'm losing will to live, I can't be coherent anymore, I think that as a media organization, we have to make the call if are we being exploitative as a media organization by trying to engage with this person after they have made statements like that? And I think that maybe we could look at it like, okay, she was just being facetious and we know what she was just trying to run out the clock. But do we really know that? And does Kelly have the ability to make those choices after the 4 hours, after being low on blood sugar and after needing to go to bed at 9 o'clock? These are not decisions that I want Kelly. I don't want Kelly making any medical decisions on behalf of anybody else. She's not a psychiatrist, neither am I. We don't have the tools to make those choices right away. If we think somebody's joking around and they say something very serious, we as responsible journalists are going to take a step back and go, okay, now, should I be recording this person right now? Should I be live streaming this person right now? Should I call somebody for this person right now? Does this person need to have a community around them to help with whatever they're going through in this stressful moment? We think about things like that. And I think that at the back of Kelly's mind, she was thinking, not only am I exhausted, I know that person's exhausted. And I know the only thing that will come of it will be something that Tom loves, which is us starting to break down, go off the rails, and me go, what are you talking about, Shyla? You're not making sense. And her going, well, F you, I don't want to talk to your stupid little blog anymore. I mean, it could have happened. But, you know, I'm not blaming anybody for it not happening because that kind of controversial engagement is reserved for King Tommy. I'm the one who gets in spats and gets arrested and dragged out of places.
She gets to do that stuff, too.
Oh, it'll happen. I mean, you've achieved every single milestone along the way of Tom's path of independent journalism. I mean, we got surrounded and almost kicked out of, but stood our grounds at a Contard event. We had, let's see, people call us and threaten to sue us. People accused of high crimes like murder and kidnapping, contacting us on a personal regular basis to try and make fun of us. All of the milestones has been hit in terms of local internet celebrity. I mean, the last one that you need is being accused of criminal harassment for asking somebody in authority a question and having the actual police come and be like, Kelly, you must put your hands behind your back and give up all of your rights to property right now. We are going to put you in a holding cell while we process you for a crime that you could spend 7 years in jail for. Because Canada is maybe possibly not even a country that respects the Charter of Rights that it made up. Some municipalities, in fact, like the city of Medicine Hat, are a fucking pirate ship. And if you are on a pirate ship, guess what? Charter of Rights is out the windows. We make up bylaws here. And I remember Andy McGrogan once said to me when he was chief of police, he said, this is how the law works. He said, we got federal law, okay? Then we got provincial laws under that, okay? And then under that, we got municipal bylaws, okay? And then right under municipal bylaws is the manners your mom and dad taught you. You know, municipal bylaws, they're not really that big of a thing. I mean, you follow the rules of your mom and dad, you probably won't break any municipal bylaws, he said. Now I'm starting to think he was lying. I'm starting to think he had it backwards and he was just lying to me. What he actually thinks is, the most important thing is that local city police enforce municipal bylaws. And if you have control over the local city police, you can get them to do all kinds of crazy bullshit. You can get them to just break into people's houses without warrants and take their computers and be like, you're, you know, something wrong. You can do all kinds of crazy shit. So I think that, we got to get on to Counselor Sharp's non-apology here. Chat TV, thanks so much, Eli, for getting the shot. Let's watch what we got here. There was sort of like a preamble with a guy who is...
Kimball Carpet One.
I'm giving you advertising money there. We are, I guess. We're going to watch your ads. But they had a guy sort of at the start who was talking about mental health at work and stress, and that was kind of unrelated. We're going to get to the good part right away. Dan Rainish.
This is Adrian who got the story, not Eli this time.
Sorry, Adrian, my apologies. And let's get right to the meat and the potatoes. The apology. People love internet apologies. If you watch YouTube videos, if you're a YouTuber out there, I know that, you know, you've probably come across at least one YouTube apology video. And these are the cream of the crop of content. When you got somebody and you got them, you know what I mean? And they have to publicly apologize and they do a bad job at it. Here's Shyla Sharpe performing that act.
To say to chat television.
If anybody was truly offended, like, and I mean truly offended by what I said, number one, you can call me and text me and I'd be happy to, you don't have to do it on social media and you don't have to internalize it. You get to say it to me and I will listen to you and I will apologize to you right to your face again because my intention is never to hurt anyone like that. But I also like everyone to just calm down a little bit and look at people's intentions.
Your fault if you're offended, okay? Like, that's your fault if you're offended by that. I only want to talk to people that are truly offended, because if you're only a little bit offended, I don't have time for that, because I know there's a fucking ton of people that are a little bit offended. But if you really are offended, you can contact me. No, you can't. I can't. I mean, Shiloh, we used to hang out every once in a while. It's a small town. We used to drink wine together and stuff like that. We were friends on Facebook until you blocked me. Now I can't reach out to you. Like I said, you're about as transparent as the thin walls in the cheap apartments that I've lived in over my life of poverty. I think I have the message here that I wrote to Shyla. I sent her a message because, I mean, she said in this interview, she says, you can write me a message directly if you are offended and I will respond right to your blah, 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 blah. Okay.
Doesn't want people to have to go on social media. Well, you know what? You are on the internet, you were in public, this is a public statement. Yeah, they should be offended in public, absolutely.
Yeah, and I think like that she looks at social media right away and says, that, oh God, I gotta protect myself from social media. You can't use social media. While also signing up for the Sentinel, a local fake news website so that she can write fake news articles to son of a bitch the mayor if she wants to, which really seems like what's happening. I gotta reach out to Craig Elder and he's gonna have to explain everything. And if he can't, then we're just gonna have to go with our narrative of this is what we know. Here are the facts. We got a whole bunch of people that are in one camp that are all seemingly using this fake news website to do bullshit. Like I said,
you're in the 2021 civic election. Craig Elder also started up that Facebook page, the Medicine Hat Civic Election, right? And there was a lot of engagement on there, and he was on there quite a bit. And so, yeah, he hasn't been silent behind the scenes.
I think Shyla Sharpe has now also blocked me on Messenger as well. I thought maybe that I had... see here.
Well, you should send an email to her at the city, unless she blocked you there too.
Right, yeah, I think maybe it was via email. Let's see here. I will have to check it out. Where did I send it through? Because I mean, it's just so hard to reach this person at this point. It doesn't really seem to matter what kind of I got an email back from Sun City Sentinel. It says, due to the inappropriate nature of the content you submitted, we can't publish your submission. And then there's no name on it. It just says admin. So we know that it came from you, Craig. Craig, we know that your email is admin at Sun City Sentinel. We know. Okay, so what was inappropriate about it? It was just lyrics to a song. What? Tell me what's so inappropriate. Does it say the F word in the song? I mean, Maybe I'll get something else and I'll throw it on there and see what happens. Sun City Sentinel. What a joke. Yeah, but I basically had sent a message over to Shyla, just saying, you know, like you're saying that you're all transparency this, transparency that. I cannot get a hold of you. You won't respond to anything. You're saying things like in public that are abhorrent, in my opinion. I want to talk to you about those things. No, you'll only do the it was a 2-minute story on ChatTV where the last, I think, 16 seconds were a quote from Shyla given a half-assed non-apology, blaming anybody who feels offended, challenging them to come out of the woodwork. Don't use social media to complain about me. Come say it to my face, and I'll say it sorry right to you, but I'll say it in a way that makes you feel like you did something wrong. What a weird apology. So weird. I mean, like, if I got an employee, and I got him doing something wrong, I say, look, you were supposed to work the till today. Somebody came through to buy sausage and egg, and apparently you said something about doing a self-harm or self-death to them at the register. They were offended by that. They contacted management. I'm down here to ask you about what's going on. What happened at the register? And my employee says, well, it's not my fault if they're offended when I make a little remark about people and myself. I mean, I was exhausted at work, boss. And I told them, I'm so exhausted. Okay, I've been working 4-hour shift today. Okay, and I hate work. I don't like talking to people. And I just told her I wanted to K myself. I wanted to go off. I wanted to hit the switch and go off. That's what I said to the person buying eggs and sausages, boss. I'm going, okay, look, I own a grocery store, not a psychiatry office. I don't want you talking to people about how you feel about work. And if you need to take a break or if you need to leave early, you need to ask your supervisor, John, about that and just go, okay? I don't want calls into management about you talking about self-harm to people going through the register, okay? Okay, go back to work now. Shyla, okay.
You know what? I was sitting in the Riverside Veterans Memorial Park last summer, and I was sitting with one of, you know, the people of the park, one of the unhoused, and he had said that he was going to harm himself. So you know what I did? I called 911.
Well, I think we know, and I think the sad part about this is that we know that when somebody who is desperate for some clothing and some food and a place to live, clean water to drink, is in a desperate situation. And when they say something like, I'm losing the will to live, they effing mean it. That they are literally thinking about jumping off the bridge. They're thinking about ending it all because they can't stand how much it hurts to be in a position of, I have no power. I have no power over anything. Everything is just happening around me. And
I'm not a psychiatrist. I don't know if the person was serious.
But what I'm saying is, the sad part is that it's very easy for us to make the assumption that a person in a financially desperate situation who's living outdoors is much more likely very, very honest about what they're saying when they're talking about self-harm ideas. When a person like Shyla Sharps, who drove her Mercedes-Benz to work and probably had lunch that day and probably can use a city credit card to travel to other places to have lunch at beautiful restaurants. She's had lunch, she's had supper, she's had the snack, she's had clean water there in front of her desk all day long, access to a bathroom. I mean, she has everything that makes a person feel dignity and is still able to say something so indignant. That we know that when somebody like that says something like that, that they're being facetious. And they're saying it because they know they can punch down, and that's supposed to be the joke. The joke, the punchline of the joke for Shyla is, I am so exhausted that I could just K myself, right? Ha ha ha. Because she damn well knows that she is not truly at a level of exhaustion, and that exaggeration is supposed to be the funny part. You're supposed to laugh because she exaggerated from, I'm a little bit hungry and I would like to listen to my favorite song in the leather seat with my handle-warmed Mercedes-Benz as I drive back to my palace 3 kilometers from the plebs, and then I can go play with my purebred dogs. I want to be a queen just like Anne. Give me my $300,000. Where's my unlimited wealth and free credit card? That's what she wants, okay? She's saying that because she is making the joke that her life is so cushy that the very worst thing she could ever experience is having to stay 15 minutes after work so that democracy doesn't fucking fall apart. All right, no, the you out there who are watching right now have probably stayed 15 minutes extra after work because your stupid manager didn't get the stuff off of the truck and you had to unload the frig. I mean, there are so many stupid reasons why people who are paid minimum wage stay 15 minutes after work and sometimes don't even frigging get paid for it because their manager makes them clock out before they go to their locker and change out of their outfit and put their, and they did XYZ. 15 minutes is stolen from poor people who get $15 an hour all day long working 12-hour shifts. And this person who owns a lawyering immigration business making, I would guess, hundreds of thousands of dollars a year, maybe less, I don't know. We're going to guess just based on the way that she drives the Mercedes around all the time. But she's got a big building downtown. She constantly brags about how she wants her business to succeed and how it's so important that businesses downtown make money instead of these people defecating in her kingdom and all these poor people all around. Her actions...
Well, we should maybe mention a few sponsors. We're going on 3 hours now.
We are. Time is flying right by. Yeah, we're at 2:16. We'll go right back to the sponsors here. I like having Shyla's face looking exhausted up on screen. It's just right now I think people are looking for that kind of content. They're like, can we get an exhausted Shyla bad apology? Good job. It was Gavin. Adrian Saint-Ange. Thank you very much, Adrian Saint-Ange from ChatTV, for getting that clip. We got to hold their feet to the fire. You must ask a decent question to try and get her to apologize. Maybe try pushing harder. If you're going to stay down there and try and exhaust the exhaustion, keep asking the same question. Tell her that was an apology. You know what? You just said some words, Shyla, but none of it was an apology. In fact, you blamed people for interpreting what you said in a way that would hurt them. That's kind of like victim blaming. Do you want to try again? Oh, like, we'll cut this part of the interview. This is not going live. We'll cut this part, Shyla. Try again. Just put her in the hot seat. She's a politician who owns a business who's trying to get out of paying taxes so she can get richer. Come on, people. If this is a kingdom, we are all just the court gestures and the serfdom and all the plebs out there. So us dirty plebs can have a little bit of fun. You know what I mean? We can drink our libations and we can gesture toward the queen.
Not paying taxes this year downtown. The Cypress Club. Mm-hmm. They got exemption this year for the very first time. You know, all the wealthy people that spend, you know, nearly $1,000 a year, well, maybe not for every membership, to be a member of the club so that they can go there and eat and stuff. They can't afford to pay their taxes, so.
Okay, well, I am going to put an offer out there publicly. Unless the Cypress Club is a cabal of rich old guys making secret plans to control the city, then buy Kelly and I a membership. All right? What? You can't spare the $1,000 to have democracy make sure that there's a fifth estate looking out for the people? Oh, come on, Cypress Club. You guys don't have the cash to pony up $1,000? Oh, wait. Is it the fact that you wouldn't want to sit at a table with us? Oh, shit. I can sense the collective testicle shrinkage that is happening right now to those Cypress Club members that are listening. And if you are truly a person of mettle, honor, bravery, patriotism even, I think that you should suggest to your fellow Cypress Club members, let's get Tommy in here. I mean, what's he gonna do? What could he possibly do? We're clean as a whistle. We're not doing anything wrong. Every conversation that happens in the walls of the Cypress Club, everybody should know publicly. It's totally fair. We should let everybody know. We're getting the tax money for free. Let's let Tommy in here. Let's let Kelly in here. Let's let them have conversations with us and eat with us and bump elbows and whatnot.
Okay, I'm just looking at the membership. So for a primary member, annual dues of $600 per year plus GST plus an annual usage requirement of $900 per year plus GST. They charge that to your account at $75 a month. So, yeah.
So like I said, if the folks who attend the Cypress Club are, I mean, first of all, everybody out there watching is now paying for their leisure to have a, what seems to be, secret club downtown with the big green door where, you know, I mean, it almost seems like a Masonic lodge, really. It almost seems like they're doing play Freemason, you know? Like, they're like, we're pretending to be a club where you have to have a fraternity handshake to get in. Okay, guys, you're not that. You're taking the tax money to have your club or whatever, right? So if anything untoward is happening in there, it would beg that you would not want Kelly or I to go in there. You would want to keep the trash pandas out. You wouldn't want anybody looking at your receipts. You would probably have people in the club that are people that you wouldn't want the public to know that they're talking about things like this, you know, behind closed doors. So I challenge you, Cypress Club. You know, if you guys got the balls, how about you pay for Kelly and I to have a membership? We're not going to go every night. We don't have time to hang out with you freaking weirdos. We probably don't even like the same music or, you know what I mean? But every once in a while, you know, we could tap in, you know, and we'll just come by and, you know, we'll hang out. We'll shoot the shit. I think probably some of you guys, you're going to end up liking me and Kelly more than you thought, because a lot of y'all have been brainwashed. There's a bunch of this old cabal of what we used to call Old Boys Club. Now we're calling it the Old Guard, you know, fitting, because the Old Guard is like a sentinel, and everybody on the sentinel part of the Old Guard. But, you know, if we're going to talk about that Old Guard, man, if you guys like don't exist, then get me in the Cypress Club. If you guys do exist, it's totally obvious what's going on. You're stealing our money to pay for your secret club, and you don't want the trash panda to know anything because you're afraid of us, because we know too much and we're good at researching and we find things out and we understand your bullshit. So, okay, we get it, right? Kelly, what would you ask them if you got in the Cypress Club when we were just sitting there eating chicken wings? What would be the first question on your mind?
I'd want to know who at City Hall is a member.
Good question. Employees, staff? So that,
one year, Ted Clugston charged a membership to his expense account. In fact, there was two memberships that year for $890 each, I believe.
Dude, you can charge memberships to secret clubs on your card when you're at work? That's crazy. Like, I mean, okay, so the way I would look at it as the taxpayer is that, you know, if I elect Ted Clugston, I vote for him, you know, even though he's got a DUI, whatever. He's probably the best guy around the thing. All right, so let's let him in, right? Now he goes and spends his money on going to a secret club, and the freaking money is spent through the taxes because we gave him the money for it or whatever. Then doesn't the public, shouldn't we know, like, what he's doing at that secret club or whatever? Like, shouldn't we know if he got some document there, if he's sending emails and messages, shouldn't we know? I mean, maybe we should go way back in the FOIPs. You know, Kelly, like I said, if we land some money, of course we got to eat. But, man, we got to go down to that FOIP office with just stacks of bills and be like, we want to know every email that Ted Clugston sent to the Cypress Club.
Okay, I'm looking it up right now. I got the amount wrong. $480 was charged under office supplies for the Cypress Club yearly membership. And this is under the 2018 travel report for mayors and counselors. I'll send you the link here.
Oh, I see how he does it. Okay, so Ted's really good with accounting and whatnot, right? He invests people's money and things like that. So what happens is when you join the Cypress Club, they give you a pen. And so that's considered stationery. So that's why it's office supplies. I get it. Ted has a pen that says Cypress Club on it, and that's he got the city to pay $400 for that pen under office supplies.
A little further, it's under mayor's administration, another $480 under food and beverages for Cypress Club yearly membership.
Oh, he split it up. When we were listening to the audit, it broke in a little quick, and the lady who was giving the presentation from MNP was live hot mic'd while they were supposed to be in closed session. And one of the things she was talking about was splitting things up, Because if something gets over $1,000, all of a sudden there's a little bit more checky-checky-roo on the spending. So Ted knew about that, and instead of spending $500, he spent $480 two times. X2 on the $480, because he knew. Nobody's going to find out. I know how to spend $500. Dude, you knew how to spend $500 until Tom and Kelly got hungry and started making people happy about knowing shit. Dude, we're going to dig it all up. You got skeletons in your closet? Guess what? Kelly and I are coming for them. It's content for us. It's hilarious. People love watching certain kinds of shit, right? We found out what that certain kinds of shit is, and it turns out me and Kelly love that shit. We were like, at first, you know, it'd be nice. We can maybe do the weather, and then we'll do a report with the bank. You know what? Fucking look outside. It's sunny today. We got some shit we dug up out of somebody's closet. We got lawsuits. We got all kinds of shit. Please help us out. We spend a lot of money on FOIPs. We know we're going to draw big cash on FOIPs. Do you know what a FOIP is, people? Okay, a FOIP is a freedom of information. Okay, now that means we go to the city. We go to the police station. We go to some, I don't know, big company that has contracts with the city. And we say, listen, you guys are required by law, federal and provincial, to give us these documents. Kind of like what the mayor was saying on Monday. You have to give us these documents, all right? Here is a request form filled out, stamped, signed, copied. You guys have 90 days to respond. It's kind of like a lawsuit. It's like, listen, I'm suing you for information, okay? I don't want money. I need you to provide the documents, and legally you have to, okay? Now, Kelly and I go down to the city hall, and we got a freaking stack right now. I think we're up to like 11 FOIPs that we need to do, just the son of a bitch what's going on with the mayor versus the city manager and Shyla Sharps and where the money goes and this character Ian Parkinson and freaking Rogers is involved. We got a freaking telecommunications company involved. All right, I'm ready to fight. You know, get telecommunication company. This is my town, all right? I'm King Tommy, and I got the telecommunications company around here, all right? So back off. The reason I roll up my sleeves is because I thought it was very apropos. If you watch the entire Monday night meeting, you will see Shyla take off her jacket, and then very soon afterwards, Ann Mitchell take off her jacket. They both expose their arms. It's like they're getting armed for battle, you know? Like they're, yeah, they're getting the guns out, right? I want to thank some sponsors who are going to feed me today. Kelly, I don't know if you got time. Let's get on the bikes. Let's go over to Crust Pizza. Let's slam a pizza today and make some pizza content. I love that kind. Kelly has probably been to Truckers way more times than I have. She's lived around here a lot longer. Husband who's in trucking. And I think probably they kind of grew an affinity for places like this, because when she told me about the last time she went, it was like she's regaling a story of a distant relative that she loves to go visit. And Truckers is that distant relative you love to go visit. They're not too far away. They're on the highway right between Medicine Hat and Red Cliff. It used to be 24/7 because, you know, that's just the Truckers needed that. During COVID, they had to scale back because, you know, business was totally effed. I mean, if you're a restaurant owner right now, you are still tightening the belt to try and bring things back to norm. You know, they've only really had a year to rebound with normal sort of, you know, regulations. So right now, Truckers opens at 6 a.m. They close at 11 p.m. That's a heck of a lot of time to get in there for a Mac burger. You know, maybe you want to sit down and have a real classic milkshake. The poutine always kills it there. When I ask people what's their favorite at Truckers, poutine always hits the top. You get the curly fries poutine, something like that. And the reason people love it is because it feels like home. You know, they cook it up in a way that's like home. They got a chef back there who, he's a homeowner. He's a family man. He's a dude that people love. The owners are local people. This isn't some big chain restaurant that's trying to save money at every corner by serving crap. They serve really good food at Truckers. Shouts out to Truckers. A couple articles on the website here. Kelly has been working hard. Every time I scroll now, I'm thinking, Kelly, you know what we got to get more of? We gotta get more of these shots. Like, see the bottom right there. We gotta get more shots like that to use for the thumbnails, because I feel like I know what you're providing. You're giving us a little taste. You're like, look, I got the receipts. You gotta believe me, okay, Kelly? People believe you at this point. You don't need to fight for the being believed part so much. The scales are starting to balance out. where they know Kelly's there for them. Like Tom, I don't know what the fuck he's there for. He seems to be there for some future goal of democracy that seems very, I don't know, fantastical. But Kelly's living in the now. She's got some goals of, like, let's figure out what's going on. I got the receipts. I think I figured some stuff out. I want to prove it to you. Kelly still feels like she's got to kind of weigh on the side of precaution that she might not be believed because she's working with community TV and it's just a little web thing, whatever. Kelly,
no.
There are thousands of people at this point. There are people walking up to Kelly in public, slipping her 50s, going like, this shit is off the hook. We love watching it. You guys are making municipal politics interesting, informing us. We're getting riled up. We like being riled up. The public loves having a reason to get the pitchforks and the torches out. You know, that was funny, actually, during the meeting when Knodel said she wanted to pass the torch over to Sean Champagne. And I was thinking, fuck, you guys could probably keep that torch language out of your mouth right now. These people up here in the galley, they don't even care about your don't cheer. You know what I mean? You might catch one of them outside with a stick and a rag on it starting to light it up. You know, the purge could be coming. I don't know. I'm just a storyteller, but sounds like people are getting mad. Kelly, like I said, I love that you're putting the receipts right there. However, I need more facial expressions of what's going on. I know why you got the camera out, right? And we're doing the live. We're 4.5 hours into the thing. I'm barely awake, sitting here trying to stay awake. I got my wine out. Okay. I'm sticking with you, Kelly. We're going all the way to the end of this thing until the gavel pounds. I'm sitting here listening to every word. I can't have you down there and me fucking off having a sandwich or whatever. So I'm sitting there listening and everything. You know, it gets to the very end. I mean, I'm not surprised that you didn't want to go there. But at that very end, you still had the inclination to zoom in and get the shot on people's faces. Because that's what really matters. And you know that's what the people want to see. I think that whatever the next couple receipts that we put out here, or even we might want to go back and update some of them here. I want cringe faces of city managers, cringe faces of politicians, local municipal councilors. You know what? I think if we got something up there, I think just to sort of counteract the bullshit Sentinel narrative that's going on, they tend to use pictures of the mayor that appear to make her look stressed out. And then they have an article about how you're a conspiracy theorist if you follow anything she's saying. Like, maybe we should search out some of the better, more confident looking pictures of the mayor. And use those as the thumbnails for the articles. I think there's a lot that is said by the aesthetics overall of a landing page for news. When I look at the Sun City Sentinel, friggin' clear as day. That is a rag against the mayor. That is a cabal of like people that think they're not going to get outed. You look like a bunch of fools, all of you people that signed up to write articles on there. Now, I'm going to have to talk to Gwendolyn Dirk. I think Gwendolyn Dirk is a very busy person who's involved in all kinds of different social media, trying to get her message out there. You know, as a politician in Alberta, you look for different places where you can engage and has engaged with community TV many times. She doesn't ask questions like who are you and how are you going to frame this? You know, she asks questions like how was your day, Tom? You want to start recording now? So Gwendolyn Dirk is somebody who will, I think, copy and paste out maybe a PR type message and send it out. And if there's something that has sent her a message saying, hey, we're a local blog, we want to put you, she'll send it to there. So I've seen Gwendolyn Dirk on there. I think I want to contact Gwendolyn specifically to give her some info on what that website is being used for. And that maybe her articles are being used as fluff to make it look like they are not a complete bullshit website. But I'm talking about the Sentinel, of course. In the background, I have Community TV, Medicine Hat's web-based broadcaster. That's us, the Trash Panda. You know, we'll hop in the garbage cans and go in the dumpsters to get the receipts. And what that means, as I said, is digitally, we will get these receipts. Going in the dumpster, proverbially, nowadays, means that we go to a city office and we submit FOIPs. Kelly is getting really good at writing FOIPs. I mean, the AI right now can do a lot of brilliant things. And it's because its language model has been trained by brilliant people who write things that make a lot of sense. Every once in a while, I go off the rails, like, I could grab the AI and make it write something for me, you know what I mean? It'd save a little time, maybe. But Kelly is really good at writing. And not only is she good at writing, she's good at a certain type of writing, which is a more of a procedural academic type writing. I don't know, maybe she picked that up while she was fighting with hospitals about whether or not her husband should die right away. That's another story altogether, which gets told over the, you know, lexicon of our community TV channel here. But guess what I'm saying is, you're getting so good at writing these foips that I can't fucking afford to keep up with how quickly you can produce them, and we need people to help us out. Folks, if you are watching this broadcast and you think it's important what the Trash Panda's been doing, if you think it's important that we go out there and we get the story, we get the shot, we get the receipts, we gotta spend money on these foips. And I'm freaking serious about this. I do not have hundreds of dollars to just go in and drop. We could easily, like I said, if we win the lottery, if we got that, I don't know, I'll write some grants for the city, actually. I'm going to see if the city will pay me to go and send a bitch them. But we're gonna try and do everything we can, bag, borrow, and steal. What we need you to do is bag, borrow, and steal for us. Instead of supporting, you know, some crap out there that you're not really using. I don't know if you get a Disney Plus subscription and you haven't watched it in a month. Screw that, you know. There's enough stuff on YouTube. You like your premium subscription over here. There's no commercials on YouTube. How about you pay us a couple bucks, $2 a month, you can hate watch. You just get it for basically for free. I mean, $2 is like nothing for most people. You know, for, what is it, $10, you can be an actual supporter. We like you. Then we like you. You send us your email, and if we like you, we're gonna link up. I'm going to maybe hook you up with some buttons. Maybe we can hang out and have a beer or a glass of wine somewhere. Maybe you want to just treat me and Kelly to dinner. You know, maybe you got a P card from the city, and you're allowed to just use that, no fucking oversight at all, and you're pissed at the city because your job's all fucked up and everything that's a pirate ship that you're working on, and you're just like, you know what, screw this, I'm taking my city credit card, I'm calling up Kelly, and I'm like, you know what, Kelly, you are going to have an extravagant meal tonight. And then just, me and Kelly and some worker from the city who's just like ready to retire. If you're just ready to retire, right? And you know you've got a lawsuit against the city, you're going to settle. Take us out on the company credit card just for funsies. We won't live broadcast it. We'll just sit there and eat steak with you and laugh all night. It'll be great. But yeah, like I said, we need the money to spend it on the FOIPs. We got to go down to City Hall and literally pay the city to tell us what the fuck is going on in there, okay? Because the city councilors don't seem to know. The mayor herself is like begging just to know what's going on. You guys won't let me in the building and shit. You guys won't let me do my job. You guys are paying me less. I'm still coming to work. I want to know what's up. Nobody's telling. Radio silence. Crickets. Shyla saying, I don't have time for this shit. Okay, Shyla, what do you got time for then? You got time for a couple $100, Shyla? I think that you should pay, Shyla should pay the $666 lifetime membership right now. Because we can use that $600 right now to freaking, I gotta get maybe the company vehicles filled up with gas. By the way, those company vehicles right now are motorcycles, okay? We are efficient as a shoestring budget can possibly be, okay? Kelly and I share donuts, okay? We cut the donuts in half, okay? I make coffee here. No, we don't go out and get friggin' Tim Hortons. No, I know it's Tim Hortons. We don't get Starbucks every day and put, oh, I got a bunch of Starbucks in my Mercedes. No, okay? We're making our own coffee. We're splitting donuts and we're saving our money so that we can get the FOIPs done, grow this webpage, keep you guys interested, maybe get a few more advertisers. At the end of the summer, I want to grow this thing big enough so that maybe we can survive. You know, maybe we can have a little fun. Maybe Kelly and I can keep our bikes working and we can do some kind of cool and interesting trip of some kind. Maybe we do some kind of a motorcycle documentation of what's going on in the garages of Medicine Hat. I know I've always found Medicine Hat is a very interesting gem in terms of what's going on under the hoods of Medicine Hat, you know? And I don't want to have to FOIP you. Just let me in your garage. Let Kelly and I see your cool Harleys or something, and we'll go for rides. You know, stuff like we do the toy run. Friggin', it would be cool as hell to afford, like, I don't know, one of those micro drones that has an HD 4K camera, and we could just, like, throw it in the air, and it could, like, ride around next to us. We get all kinds of cool shots. Guys, you know you want to see stuff like that. You want to see Kelly and I create cool content. You know, we need the money to do it. Because like money doesn't grow on trees, and at this point in his life, Tom is no longer or was ever willing to go to department stores and steal electronics for his own benefit. That's not going to happen, all right? So just like buy us some stuff and give it to us as a gift, or if you see us in the streets, you'd be like, hey, is that Kelly? Kelly's always like, hell yeah, I'm Kelly. I'm the one you know. You know what I mean? We're not hiding, you know? If you ask anybody, oh, hey, did you write that article in the Sun City Sentinel? They're going to be like, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't write nothing. Sun City Sentinel, never heard of it. Those guys are going to go hide. Tom and Kelly, we're going to be out here in public, no problem. You know what I mean? I mean, frig, I'm so out here in public, people walk up to me at the Salvation Army and want to throw down dukes for some reason. I guess I support the LGBTQ too much. Shouts out to the gays. You know, if you're gay or whatever, you got the 2S+ transgender flags, whatever you're doing. That's cool, man. I mean, that's cool. I'm sitting here smoking hash all day long, and people think that I'm an alien from another planet because I like a herb that grows naturally from the earth. It seems absurd to me. I mean, y'all out there want to have sex in certain kind of ways? I don't want to get in your bedroom. I don't want to watch. Well, I mean, I haven't met you yet. I mean, if we got into some kind of personal situation, maybe watching would be something that we'd all be interested in. But that's consensual stuff we should talk about at a completely different juncture.
Yes.
We should probably call back up to Smoosh and see if they want to get back in now that we're super popular again. Thanks so much, Kelly, for, of course, writing these great articles on the website. Like I said, I'm maybe more of a visual learner, and when I scroll through, oh man, do I ever want to click on Andy McGrogan's face? Look at him. He's just pinch- oh, fuck, do I have to answer these questions? The title being, the mayor of Medicine Hat has been banished. Can council members take the slack? Doubtful. Okay, the word doubtful associated with the look on his face. That is the Parmesan cheese on top of the spaghetti that is community TV. Thank you so much for adding so much to the standard pizza that I am always serving here. We needed something a little bit more elegant on the menu. So if you guys like the pizza that Tom is willing to eat off of the floor at 2 o'clock in the morning, you got the videos that I create, sometimes a little bit harsh in nature. Sometimes when I present these live broadcasts, I am the voice of unreasonable extreme. Kelly, of course, is the balancing act that makes this sometimes viewable to those who are living in a dimension that's maybe a little bit more academic. But, you know, we work together really well. We see the world in a very similar way from different perspectives, and we have a lot of fun doing it in private. We try to exhibit that fun in public for you, and we have appreciated all of your contributions and help as of late. You know, Kelly called me up from that City Hall meeting, or sent a message or something like that, and she was like, hey, people have given me over $100 cash. And I was like, yes, that's another one of those milestones. You know what I mean? Just being out in public, doing your job properly. You don't have an hourly rate that's a guaranteed number. You're sitting there at that city council meeting thinking, is this fucking worth it at all? Like, I'm getting tired. No, sick and tired. I mean, I got the will to live, but I would rather be sleeping while alive right now. Or at comfortable home with my cat and my bird. So, you know, we try to afford Kelly all of the comforts that are possible. And the only way we can do that is with the contributions. I love the fact that Kelly had a 3-digit number and just walked out of there feeling confident, happy, and proud with the work that she's doing. So anytime you see Kelly in the streets, if you got your fist balled up, better have some fucking dollar bills in there. At least a 20, you know what I mean? So, but like I said, we're not too proud. If you're somebody that isn't working with tons of money, and you're somebody that just loves what we're doing, you can't afford to, you don't got credit cards, to $2 a month, whatever. If you're throwing us a 5, if you're saying come have coffee, if you're saying, you know what, down at station, I put one of them things up on the free coffee board, and it says, you know, independent journalist. Guess who that's for? You know, there ain't a whole ton of us around, you know? We would love that kind of thing. You know, or like I said, if you want to grab the city's credit card and go off the hook with us, shit, there's a movie that came out in the 90s called Mo Money. It was a Wayans Brothers movie. Damon Wayans figures out how to scam credit cards, and him and his brother go crazy, and they buy everything on credit cards. Do a 1990s movie montage with us. A Mo Money Medicine Hat movie montage. There's a lot of M's there, okay? Is there somebody named like Michael Moore that works for the city that would like to retire and come out with us with the credit card? We will we will help you spend it. We will do some we will pretty woman the city for you with us. Or you know what I mean? Yeah, I knew Kelly would get that one, right? We'll walk back in there and we'll be like, we're buying all of the electricity you have, City of Medicine Hat. Walk in there with a Gucci purse. You know what? We want a permit to build a watchtower. Yeah, fucking Tom and Bob are going to erect a freaking radio tower in the flats. It's 600 feet tall. Yeah, we get a permit to broadcast pirate radio off the pirate ship here. thanks again to the sponsors. The guys downtown at the Three Brothers Pizza, Medicine Hat Pizza, they're back on board. It's been a while since we had them. Sod actually had to basically run the place himself now. He had a whole family here from Kashmir. They've gone back out to the homelands. And now this young man, he's got a young family. He's got kids. He's married now. Stuff has changed quickly in his life. He's running the pizza shop downtown. He's working hard doing it, making lots of friends. He's a community guy. And go downtown, grab a slice of pizza. It's like one of the only places in downtown Medicine Hat where you can spend like a couple bucks and get an actual like little meal. You know, you're getting a pop and a pizza slice for like, I think it's $6, something like that. Maybe five, I don't remember. But I think a slice is three. So I don't know, maybe it's $5. Anyway, it's real cheap. It's a decent pizza too. And I am a fucking pizza connoisseur. Born and raised in Halifax around like the Lebanese pizza mafia. I know my pizza, okay? These guys that fed me pizza as a child while I was growing up were so serious about pizza. You know, you could get hurt if the pizza wasn't right. You know what I'm saying? Thank you so much for watching. Kelly, anything we got to say before we close this one off? It has been 2 hours and 46 minutes. God damn, we work hard.
Yes, we do. I think that we'll just keep you posted. We're still waiting for that whistleblower policy to come forward. They've only been working on it for 2 years, and you know, Ann Mitchell did say, oh, it's going to come to council soon. Well, it wasn't on this last week's agenda. So we should step and wait, I guess.
That's like one of those words that you hear, like whistleblower. That's like one of those words you hear when there's like a huge corruption thing or like somebody's been stealing or like talking about that. Like, it seems like these words that are coming into the lexicon of the City of Medicine Hat, pecuniary interests. Commissioner of integrity investigation, lawsuit, settlement, all these words. These are hot button words. Hashtag all these words. I think people are now searching the internet, even looking for like what's going on in other people's municipalities. I don't think there's a lot of places that have Kellys and Toms that are actually like kicking in the doors of City Hall and being like, we want to spend all our money on FOIPs. So, you know, maybe this is not an uncommon thing. You know, people like Ann Mitchell, they're not necessarily unique and they don't necessarily quarantine to one certain area. I mean, like we said earlier, it appears as if she's gone through CU Falls and made a couple people over there not so happy because they have contacted us. And think about that, Ann Mitchell, you know, like somebody's going to tell her, right? Tell Ann Mitchell, Tommy, tell her King Tommy said, we're talking to people from CU Falls. We have ongoing conversations. In fact, Ann Mitchell, I would like you to know at this juncture that Kelly and I are conducting an investigation on you, okay? Ann Mitchell, be aware that the Trash Panda is currently conducting an investigation on you, okay? Now, what we would just appreciate it if you didn't obstruct us, okay? We would appreciate it if you obey, okay? We just need your obedience during this process so that we can figure things out. Do you understand that, Ann Mitchell? Do you understand what we're saying?
People have contacted us out of the blue because they've been reading my work and they said, oh, it looks like, you know, something similar happened to what was going on back in Sioux Lookout. So
the Trash Panda has become something of a confidence, a public trust. People know that some people say, Man, I contact the trash panda before I'm calling the police. I've called the police before, man. That didn't work out. I ended up in jail last time I called the police. That was fucked. But, man, when I call the trash panda, they look into some shit. Now, it depends. This might be something that we could just jump on right away. Well, look, we got the shot. Let's go out in public. Look, they're doing it right now. We could catch them live in 4K. Or maybe it's something where we got to spend a little time digging. Maybe we got to do a couple foibs. Maybe we got to hold the cards close to our chest in this game of Texas Hold'em. You know, but we know how to play, all right? Kelly and I are getting schooled on how this shit works so well that they literally have kicked us out of the casino, okay? We walked in there and we were like, hello, we are independent journalists who do not get paid any money at all to tell stories. We just want to do what our charter right tells us we're allowed to do. And they said, no, fuck that. We're so scared of you guys that we are going to label you as criminals instead of allowing you to just record us, which you're legally allowed to do. Holy crap, dude. That's like walking into a casino. Me and Kelly just strutting into the casino. And the casino owner coming up to us and going, listen, Rain Man, okay? This guy right here is not allowed to gamble at our casino because we have seen evidence of him doing so well at other casinos that those casinos had to close down and pay him settlement money out of their insurance, and the insurance company won't back the casino anymore because they let the guy in and he's too fucking good at blackjack, okay? You sit Tommy down at the blackjack table, you're done. You're done. It doesn't matter how long it takes him. It could be 40 minutes. It could be 4 hours. It could be 4 days. But if he keeps coming back to the same blackjack table, you're fucked. You're fucked. And everybody knows that. And you let him in? All right. So that's what's happening in Medicine Hat right now. All right. Rain Man walks into the fucking casino, which is City Hall. He's got, well, I guess I can lovingly refer to you as, what was it? Dustin Hoffman's brother in Rain Man was,
I'm drawing a blank.
I'm drawing a blank too. Great actor. Can't I think of it? Is it it's the Mission Impossible guy, right?
Yes. Yeah.
Jump on the couch with Oprah.
Yeah.
Scientology. what is his name? In the comment section. I know you're screaming it right now. I'm just gonna go to the comment section. Is anybody there to remind me of the name of the anyways, that's you. We walked into the casino. I'm losing them now, okay? We walk into the casino, which is the city of Medicine Hat. We say we're journalists. They say you guys are professional gamblers. They say you're not allowed in this casino because it appears that Kelly is somehow able to game the system. She has so much experience in dealing with these systems that she is somehow able to game the system. We don't know if she's cheating. We don't know if she has some kind of memory system that allows her to memorize four decks of cards. Tom over here, it seems as if they've maybe caught him with some kind of listening device. I don't know what's going on, but these guys cannot come in our casino. Think about that, folks. You're a member of the public. You look at two independent journalists. People are saying, those guys, we don't like them. They're blah, 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 blah. They say bad stuff about us. Think about that. It's the casino saying bad stuff about us because they don't want us to get in there and clear them out. And that's what's going on with the city. They're afraid of independent journalists because they know we have the time. We are going to get down to the bottom of it. This isn't some $16 an hour paid job where we're going to take a lunch break, move on to the next thing, and try and keep our mind filled with whatever, you know, entertains the public. Every once in a while, we get just as riled up as you. We get so fucking pissed. We do 3 hour long live episode where Tom just rambles on about a bunch of metaphors that only certain people are going to enjoy. Kelly enjoys them. She laughs. You know, that's really my goal, is to keep Kelly happy. If I can keep Kelly happy, our pirate ship, which is smaller, armed though, and able to perform various interesting tactics on the sea, needs more money. We need a bigger ship. We need more people at the Sentinel. You know what I mean? I say that in jest. Support us. Help us out. Send us some cash. E-transfer. support@comtv.ca. If you love what Kelly's doing with the receipts, you see them in the background there. Send it directly to Kelly. Kelly@comtv.ca. And you know what, like, don't worry about, like, telling the friggin' tax man about where you sent the money or whatever. We're not, like, a charity organization. We can't send you a tax receipt. And also, like, you know, whatever. I would probably maybe report whatever in taxes that we can, because, you know, it's a little easier if you just hand us cash in public, right? You know what we're talking about, hand us cash in public, right? We love that kind. And we actually would also love for our naysayers to catch us being handed money in public and then make a really big deal out of it online, because it would be just hilarious. Anyways, we love you folks who have been watching. We love you for watching live and, of course, sharing and consuming this video later. If you've got questions, put them in the comment section. Send us direct messages. We try to respond to everybody that we can. We try to, if those questions are pertinent and we understand them as something we can use, we might be FOIPing some of the stuff that you want us to FOIP. Our last live video, we went through a list of probably, I think, 10 or 11 things that we got on the FOIP list. Kelly and I are going to have to meet up, take a stack of those FOIPs, and we'll go down to City Hall. We'll make a video for you while we're down there. Kelly strutting through City Hall with all kinds of stationery, ready to throw down with the pens and papers. Folks, they always said the pen is mightier than the sword. The Sentinel, obviously, that local trashy fake news website, we're not in any way in competition with them. In fact, I think it's a joke. I hope that it continues. I want to see Shiloh Sharps put her name on a couple of articles that we can throw up on the website here and tear apart. I wonder if she can spell. I've seen articles on the website already with like grammatical and spelling errors that I'm sure if we dug deep enough, we could probably identify who the writer was, because commonly people make the same mistakes over and over, and Kelly's the type of person who knows that shit. When Kelly reads, all right, she doesn't just skim through. No. Kelly's a lot like me. Like when I'm editing a video, I'm frame by frame sometimes to find out how to make it more funny. You know, like you can just make something real interesting if you really are down to every word. And Kelly, I really like how you put some stuff together. I haven't read the most recent one. I'm going to admit I got up a little late today. I was on the wine and hash last night and slept in until 9:30. But when I'm reading your articles, I tend to think about, it's funny because a lot of the stuff that you like, such as like weird sci-fi and different kinds of like, you know, ways of referring to authority, it comes across in the, I don't know, the Trekkie lexicon of weird things to, like, nerdy ways to son of a bitch the government, and I love that kind. I love the way you write. So if you think, you know, you want to just read some articles about what's going on in Medicine Hat, I urge you to read the ones on our website, comptv.ca. If you find them interesting, you can get even more, okay? We have a top-secret login you can get into. You just got to pay us a couple bucks, become a member. Once you're a member on there, the benefits are crazy. These FOIPs that we get, we're going to talk about them online. You know, we're going to probably take some little excerpts and stuff like that. But we are literally going to just scan them, put them on the website as a PDF or whatever. You guys will be able to go there and see all of the FOIPs, everything the mayor was asking for, everything the Trash Panda is asking for. As soon as we get it out off the press, onto the website, if you're a big-time supporter, hate watcher, whatever, pay us a couple bucks. And we'll give you the receipts. You know, this is the evidence that Kelly has been using to factually tell us about what is really going on. Like I said, you don't have to believe her. You should, because it makes, you know, you can save a lot of time. But you don't have to believe Kelly, because when she puts it together, she got the receipts there. And that's something you're not going to see on a lot of legacy news websites. Sometimes you might get a link out to, you know, something that they're trying to promote. You know, maybe something they're trying to create an association with. Oh, we did something with the food bank. Here's a link to the food bank. But, you know, you don't often see in legacy news articles, you know, we got the receipts. Here's the FOIP document. Here's the legal, you know, here's the law. Here's the bylaw. You don't get that kind of thing. You just got to trust them that they understood it. Yeah, but most of the time, the problem is, and no, you know, nothing against a guy like Eli or Colin or anybody else working in these, like, you know, 10-story-a-day churn-out news operations. But when you're forced to, you know, turn everything that could have once been a nice chorizo sausage served on a brilliant presentation into a fucking hot dog, sometimes you kind of lose the context when you turn something that was once brilliant, beautiful, and spicy into something that kind of gets, you kind of got to take all that spice out because you only got a minute to tell the story. And then what happens is you end up telling Shiloh's story because you don't really get the time to challenge it. You don't get the time to, give her another opportunity to rephrase. You just kind of got to take what you got in that quick little time and head back to the station, get it edited for the 11 o'clock news. And that 11 o'clock came quick. I mean, we left that place probably they probably freaking pedaled to the metal to get back up to Redcliffe to get in front of a computer to start editing.
Eli was producing stuff right there. Well, yeah, they had to get the video camera footage, but he was right. We were at the meeting, and he was posting stuff online already. And
yeah, I mean, but to get that video back to the office is just like it's part of, I think, how the operation of filibuster works. They know that if it's news, then people might consume it. But if it's old, there's a lot less likelihood that you're going to consume it.
I was looking at the timeline of the articles, and, you know, there's this one article written by Eli, 2:30 in the morning, Tuesday morning.
Right. Us journalists are staying up late and putting in hella extra hours. He should be home in bed. He should be, I mean, he's a young man. I mean, friggin' 2 o'clock in the morning. She definitely should be getting some rest, you know, because what ends up happening is the city council forms a situation that is basically it might not be the intention that they want to cause a high stress, long situation. However, I don't think that a bunch of millionaires, when they sit down in a room, I don't think they have to talk about what's good for millionaires. They don't have to fucking talk about it. You know what? If you were a millionaire, you would know what I'm talking about. And if you are a millionaire and you're watching this right now, fuck you. You didn't buy the freaking $666 membership yet, all right? Drop some cash for the trash panda, you millionaire, all right? Even things out for the little guy. But, you know, if you're sitting there with your millions and shit, you know, trash panda's going to go looking. I'm losing my train of thought. I need to go have lunch. We got to end this one, Kelly. Thanks again for watching, folks. We love you out there for your support. Kelly gets emotional sometimes about this cash delivery in public. Guys, I want to see if you can make a teardrop fall from this badass woman's eye. Can you do it? Okay? Look at a lineup next to Kelly in public somewhere with people saying, thank you, here's $50. Thank you, here's $100. Thank you, here's the company credit card. Let's run. Let's do that shit. When I say company credit card, I mean City of Medicine Hat. You know, let's get them P-cards out. Let's have a party with the Trash Panda. Thanks again, folks. This time I'm for real. Any last sort of notes we need before we end the live?
I think we're